Welcome back, guys. This is Arnaldo, aka Mad Dog, and this is the real episode 199 of GG's The Mouthful Podcast.
GG!
Yes. Wow,
that came from space.
That did come from space.
From space!
That's because I put my microphone, I tried to put it as far from my mouth as possible because we're using headsets today, and I didn't want to turn anybody deaf.
Did you see the wizard?
The Wonderful Wizard of Oz?
The Wizard in the Moon?
Oh, nice. Nice.
That wizard came from the moon, you know?
From the moon. Those voices, of course, starting with Mr. David Santos, a.k.a. Dream Twister. What is up, sir?
Hello, Governor. It is Friday, and I'm happier than being Friday. We have our co-host. Can you introduce him for us, please?
Yes, and finally, back from a small hiatus, Mr. Chaos Reaper, a.k.a. Hiberto. What is up, sir? How is it on the other side of Florida?
I am back. It's actually kind of rainy today, and it's getting kind of hot, and I hate it.
It's hot? It's kind of cold. It's kind of chilly here.
I wish.
Oh, man.
It was like 91 degrees today, and I'm like, fuck this.
What time is it where you're at?
What time is it?
That's how big Florida is, guys.
It's like, wait, I'm not in a different time zone.
We're in five different time zones, guys.
Is it summer over there? Because evidently it's summer over there because you're hot.
It's definitely summer already.
Holy crap.
I think
it was actually, I'm not gonna lie, it was actually muggy and humid before it started raining. Then it started raining and then it got cooled off. So, but yeah, I don't know.
It's muggy. A feeling. The other day, a girl from work made fun of me because I said it was muggy outside. And she thought it was silly.
Well, I'm not going to lie. I've never heard that before.
Muggy?
Yeah, never heard it before.
Oh, I say it all the time. Muggy, right? is
clearly not around me.
This is very true.
And don't ever use it again.
That's it. Stop. I think muggy is. I think it's a good word. Yeah, it makes sense. It's a humid... It's a sticky, humid feeling.
Yeah.
I was going to say, like, it'll make sense if you tell me what it is.
Yeah. It's a sticky, humid feeling is what I assume it means.
Yeah, That's why I take it, too. That's why.
Oh, God. I'm going to have to Google this. You know what?
Yeah. Webster's Dictionary, guys, says.
Urban Dictionary says.
An unpleasant, warm, and humid feeling. Yeah. There you go.
Oh, there you go. So, we clear the mystery of muggy. It is a word, and you're using it correctly, gentlemen. Congratulations.
All right. I mean, hey, man, I got to do it every so often, you know?
See, we do educate people in this podcast.
That's right.
Giovanni Sparrowwolf would be so proud of us.
He would. Contrary to what our comments say, we do educate.
Yes. The word of today is muggy.
Muggy.
Everybody's supposed to go, well, like Pee-wee Herman's show, whenever they will describe the word of the day.
The only thing I ever remember from that show is a damn genie.
I never
the genie.
That,
yeah, the Mecca Leka High Mecca Hiney Ho.
I'm never got out.
No, you don't remember the genie.
Wow,
I remember the sofa. I mean, not the sofa, the recliner he was sitting.
The recliner, yeah.
Yeah, was that? Maybe that was Blue's Clues, and I'm getting them confused.
That wasn't a recliner, too. That was just a chair. Yeah, I think you're getting confused.
Yeah.
All right, guys. Well, we know. Thanks so much for tuning in. Please first go to goodgame.rocks. Join the conversation there. And, of course, please like, subscribe, share the podcast with everyone. What we normally do, guys, first is we go into what we've been up to, move on into various news items, and then finish with our hot topic of the week. This week's hot topic.
Hot topic.
The rumor mill. Yes, it's time to sift through all the BS and really look into some of the rumors that the gaming industry has, which I have many at this point. And we're gonna basically say which ones are real and which ones are bullshit, essentially, guys.
I think our audience comes to listen to us because they revel in the BS.
They do revel in the BS. And yes. They're going to find out how BS we are as well when half of these rumors turn out to be true.
That's right.
and we call BS on them. So yeah,
we'll have to see.
Tune in later on, but first, let us begin, guys, with what we have been up to. Mr. Chaos Reaper, what is up with you, brother?
A lot and a lot.
Oh, Final Fantasy 14 and Overwatch, dude. And Warframe.
Oh my god, I have been playing Warframe like my life depends on it.
Wow,
damn.
Yeah, I've been doing a lot of Railjack missions. With Railjack is the new ship they introduced. Mm-hmm. I've been running a lot of Railjack with Dark, which he already has the strongest possible ship. And I can tell you that it's absolutely ridiculous what this thing can do.
In what sense?
It shoots out a black hole.
Oh, shit.
Okay, that pulls out.
That is real.
All the enemies, that's all you need. A black hole maker.
It pulls all the enemies in, right? And it kind of like holds them in the center while you casually shoot them in the face and then just watch them blow up. He already has the best turrets in the front and on the sides. He already has the best engine, the best core, the best shield. He has all of this. Well, the mods for the Railjack are called avionics. He already has I don't know if he has them all, but he has most of the best avionics. It's insane. He also has an avionics that, you know, the black hole is one. The other one is that when he activates it, any bullet shot at him, it absorbs it. And then I haven't seen this in action yet, but apparently he just shoots the force out and just destroys everything. Yes, it's just absolutely really, but it's so much fun, especially when you're that OP. I mean, it's just, other than that, I've been like fishing and whatnot because I'm working on reputation for one of the open world places called Fortuna, because I need to increase the operator, which is the actual Tenno, the weapon that you use called the Amp, and the only way to upgrade it is ranking that stuff up. So I'm trying to work on that. And just doing a lot of different things, man. Building different weapons, leveling it up, trying to increase my master rank. Trying to do like various different quests and side stuff they have for like stronger weapons and everything. There's this thing called a Kuvalich where you have to capture it and then you have to piss it off for it to. I don't know, some really random shit, man.
Damn.
Yes, there is so much to do in this game, and if I had more time, I'd probably be at the same level as Dar, because this motherfucker is on almost all of it. He's still missing.
What does he do? Does he do? And if Dark, if you're listening, I'm not in any way trying to insult or anything, but there's only so much time in a day. So what is it that he does when he's not doing this?
He sleeps.
Oh.
Okay. Oh, wow.
Well, all right. Must be nice.
Yeah, I was going to say, it's a pretty sweet life right there. I ain't going to lie.
Sure, I was not going to lie. Yeah.
Please. Well, carry on, Dark.
Yeah, man. I mean, it's mostly because of him that I've been able to do so much, because it's just much more reliable to have someone that knows what they're doing, and whatever they have is like basically OP. But even before he upgraded to that point where we're doing it together, and it was just easier, even if it was just the two of us, it was just easier than with a group of randoms that like running around like maniacs, like with headless chickens, you know. Mm-hmm. So that has occupied most of my time. Everything else has been split on Apex Legends. A little bit of Apex Legends with the new season that came out. Season 4 already started with a new character, by the way. Yes, there is a new character. God, I'm going to have to talk so much just because I missed last week.
Give us the play-by-play.
The new season is out with a new character. His name is Revenant. He's not just edgy, because he is super edgy. He is a straight-up asshole. He's not just narky. No, he's an asshole. Everything that he says, even from the thank you to your welcomes that you're supposed to say, he never says any of that. Like, one of the thank you is, don't think I'm thanking you. We're like, wow, bro, okay. You're welcome.
I kind of like that, actually.
I get a kick out of it, because everybody's kind of like, what's Caustic with all his edginess, he still says thank you and like, you know, you're welcome and whatever. This dude does not. He doesn't care. He has a pretty cool backstory. He used to be a real human, because he's a robot. He's a full-on android, I guess. Yeah, there's no biological T. There's no biological. I know there's a difference between cyborg and android, and I always kind of get them confused. But he used to be human, and he was an assassin. And when I don't know if he died or got killed or whatever, but a company picked him up and brought him back to life as a robot, as an android. So he literally doesn't care. He's just out there because he wants to kill people and get revenge. So that's I actually do like the character. The abilities are interesting. The first ability is he throws his grenade that cancels out the powers of other legends for 10 seconds, which can be very useful if you want to, like, you know, not let a Pathfinder escape or a Wraith or whatever.
Yeah. Could definitely turn the tides.
Yeah, I've had a little bit of problem with it. I don't think the range is that big, but it could be just me being bad. And then his ult is he summons this totem, and he can touch it, and you get this buff. I think it's called, like, Death Sense or some shit like that. Some edgy shit like that. Death Protection? Something like that. Death something. And what this does is that if you die and you're still within range of the totem, you spawn back at the totem with one health and full shields.
Nice. I like that.
Well, it's tricky because if they're waiting for you at the totem, you're going to die.
Oh, yeah.
So you have to be really careful where you put it. You can't go too far from it either. Mm. You know, so it's kind of tricky to do. One of the good things about it is, for example, somebody dies inside of a circle that hits hard. You can literally put the totem right at the edge, run in, grab the tag, and even if you die, you'll spawn back at the totem, and you got the tag anyways. Mm-hmm. So that's one of the things that I kind of figured out that you can do with it, but it's been pretty hard for me to use right. Okay. Mortal Kombat 11. I'm trying to think what was the other one. Mortal Kombat 11. The last season ended. I did not get to Demigod. I did not get my Sub-Zero mask. I got to Grandmaster, and I think I was like 800 points away from Demigod.
Oh, wow.
So it was a challenge. It was difficult. Just to get to Grandmaster was a pain. You know, you start fading stronger and stronger opponents and people that are using more things close to the meta. So you start seeing like a pattern of characters. You know, a lot of Scorpions. The Joker is pretty strong, and because it's new, there's been a fair share of Jokers. I fought a few good ones, granted, but after you fight someone like Dark. Mm-hmm. Nah, dude. A lot of them have been pretty garbage.
Oh, wow. Yeah, I mean, I've seen his videos, man. He's...
By the way, there is a video of me and Dark fighting. I don't know if you guys saw the stream, but I did stream it.
I did see portions of the stream. I was the one who jumped in on there.
After you, if you want to watch that fight, it is on his channel, which is... I know, Mad Dog, you follow him. I don't know about you, Dream, but... it is a video. I only won one fight. Yes, it is Dark. God damn. But you see that Joker and the way that he used it and all the mix-ups and the setups that he does. And you fight another one that knows half as much and you see him as garbage. And I don't want to offend anybody, but that's just the truth.
Damn.
It's so easy to read what they do just because they're so repetitive. They're so stuck on one thing. They don't have the mix-ups and a lot of the Dark has. So it's a lot easier. It's like his Jax. I cannot beat or I haven't been able to beat Dark's Jax, but I fight any other Jax, and it's so much easier.
Okay. Well, yeah, I guess that makes sense. If you're taking on the best, that's how...
Then everybody else seems average.
Yeah, exactly. Everybody else seems average. Yeah.
So that's one of the ways that I'm actually grateful to him, because I have improved a lot. Even though the game may not be great, because it does have a fair share of flaws, but I have learned a lot about fighting. And now when I see a fighting and when I see a tournament online or whatever, like, I can see and understand what's happening. Like, I can see the tactics that they're using, the footsies and, you know, the pressure and the 50-50s. And, you know, like, I can understand it, which is really interesting.
So you're like Neo now. I can see the
fight. Yeah,
I
can see that.
Yes. Yeah, pretty much. Something like that. So that's what I've done gaming-wise. I watched in 2 weeks. I watched one movie.
No anime?
No, I haven't I'm telling you, I watched one movie, and it's because, like, I told myself I need to watch at least one show, one movie, something new, so I can say it on the podcast. Seriously.
He doesn't even want to. He's just, I need to have something that
honestly, it's like, yo, I got a lot of grinding and farming to do on Warframe. Do I really want to spend 2 hours watching a movie? Like, you know what? Let's do it. Let's just take a break and let's do it. So I went shopping with my streaming services, right? I didn't get that far. I didn't really have to go that far. I started with Hulu. I went to the movie section. I scrolled and I saw this one particular movie that I heard that was actually highly recommended by my two beautiful co-hosts here. Uh-huh. And I decided to watch it. And this movie took me on a roller coaster of emotions that I was not expecting.
Oh, shit.
I still don't know which one could it be.
Okay.
But I've seen it,
so
evidently.
So I finally watched I Kill Giants.
Oh shit, yes. Holy shit, I Killed Giants. Oh,
what? What a charming movie.
Right?
God.
Fantastic, yeah.
I couldn't peel away from it. Like, it was late. Right, and I'm like, you know what? I watch like half of it, and I watch the other half in the morning when I wake up. And I was like, nope, I gotta finish this. I have to. I went to bed like at 1:30 in the morning watching this movie.
It was a surprise, man. It was such a surprise. Obviously, I'm not gonna say what it is, but it's just one of those things where as it starts to peel away its layers, you're like, holy shit! You know what I mean? You're just seeing how. Oh yeah, it's actually I got caught off guard with that film.
I love Barbara, the main character.
The main character.
I love her.
Yeah.
I know. It's like
she talks like an adult and don't talk to me like a child. I know better.
Yes.
Okay. Yeah. I don't care about your feelings. You don't have to care about mine. I just get this conversation over with.
Oh my God. Yes.
Loved it. I loved every second. Like, it was an emotional roller coaster. I'm going to admit it. I laughed. I got angry. I got anxious. I cried. Everything.
I was gonna make that joke. I laughed. I cried. You changed my life. Yes. It is such a good one. Yes.
It was. I told my wife that we have to watch it together.
Oh, yeah. Nice. Yeah. You definitely did.
Because it was very much, like you said, it was very much a surprise, but it did come highly recommended from the both of you. And I remember that. Like, you know what?
I completely forgot that I watched that movie. Not because I didn't like it, because I really did. It's just one of those movies that I watch and then time passes on. And if I don't remember seeing it again somewhere advertised, like, I forget that I've seen it. So when when you mentioned it, I was like, wait a minute. Is that the movie?
What?
When you said that you saw it, I was like, wait a minute. Did I watch that? And then I was like, oh, wait a minute. Yes, I did.
Yeah.
Of course I did.
Which I do have some questions about that movie, but since we're not spoiling anything here, I will ask you.
Off the air, okay.
Yeah, off the air.
We're living for the spoiler cast that we're doing on.
Nice.
There might be giants.
Yeah, I was gonna say that's I don't know. Anyways, so that's what I've been up to for the last 2 weeks.
Nice, good stuff, sir. Good stuff. First off, I'm glad you checked it out. I'm glad you enjoyed it. More importantly, right? Because I mean, it's not guaranteed to be your thing.
Might I add that the movie has earned a trifecta of recommendations from this group.
Exactly. I highly recommend that movie. All angles, yeah.
He has cool. 3 out of 3.
A 3.
Yes, he has exactly. GG's 3 out of 3.
Yeah, GG's 3 out of 3. There you go.
Six thumbs up here. Mr. David Santos.
Oh, me.
Yes, that's you. What, right, sir, have you been up to?
You know, I'm still playing here and there. Bloodstained: Ritual of the Night.
How's that going?
You know what? It's finally moving again. I was not upset because, like I was telling, like I've been actually telling for the last two podcasts, I get stuck in that game, but I'm still okay because I'm still like moving around and finding, you know, secrets and all that kind of stuff. So it's still entertaining. It's still a very Metroidvania type of game. I mean, hell, it's Symphony of the Night pretty much. Mm-hmm. So I'm really liking that. But I think what I especially enjoy is that moment when I finally find what I'm missing, which in this case, I was stuck because at one point I needed to go underwater. And for the life of me, I checked that castle like left and right, up and down, everywhere, clear all the rooms that I could see. I was basically getting OP because I was getting, I was grinding without meaning to grind. I was grinding so much experience on it that I was starting to one-shot, enemies that I will need special weapons at the beginning, the first time I will face them. And I, by accident, discover a pretty cool Easter egg also. I'm not going to spoil it. But, you know, things like that. But I wasn't progressing, which is what I wanted to do. Because I'm having fun with it, but I'm ready to move on. I'll tell you why in a moment. So, but yes, I finally found the item that I needed to be able to go underwater, and now the map is starting to open again. Now things are starting to be new again, and I'm listening like different songs, because at one point you're running through the same rooms, you're listening to the same music, and you already have it memorized, but now you get into these other areas and the new music and the artwork is completely different. So it feels really good. It feels really good. Now, I'm hoping, and I don't know about, if this is going to happen or not, I'm hoping that it's not going to throw in a Symphony of the Night thing and spoilers for someone that has not played Symphony of the Night. I haven't gone to this, but I heard that you almost get to a part and then suddenly you have to run the castle again, but upside down.
Oh, from Castlevania. Oh, so you think they're going to do that?
I overheard someone mention something that made me think that either that or might throw some similar secret. Like, I don't want to feel like I have to. Like, I'm ready for the game to be over. You know, it's mm-hmm. saying that I have discovered like 70% of the castle, something like that. You know, I don't want to get to 100 and then find out like, oh, okay, now we gotta get the real castle or whatever. You know.
Oh dear.
Again. Not because I don't want to play anymore, but if he does that, I feel like I'm going to take a little break and I'm going to pick it up later on, because it's not the type of game that you have to continue to play. Otherwise, you're going to miss anything. Mm-hmm. But that soundtrack, man, I really like the soundtrack of that, of that game. Maybe because I've been subjected to it so much.
Could be.
That it has finally...
It's Stockholm Syndrome at this point.
Yeah. Like, there's a particular tune I think I posted on the group. I'm obsessed with this song. I hum it everywhere. My wife knows it, even. Of, how how many times I'm singing, playing it. But that's not the only thing that I've actually been playing. As you guys might have seen, and probably not care too much because I'm like the only one that likes this game in the group. The Division 2, it's coming out with its expansion. The Division 2, it's a game that I really, really liked playing last year. As a matter of fact, I believe I made it my game of the year of 2019. Because not just because of the time I spent on it, but because I was really liking what it was doing. It was keeping me very well entertained. For a person that typically don't like those type of looter shooters, I'm not in it for, getting my character like super OP and just keep going, I like to play the story, which admittedly it was kind of boring and terrible in The Division, because it's a Ubisoft game, and Ubisoft games can be really cool, but they can't do story for shit, evidently. But that's okay, because at least I'm getting very entertained with the gameplay aspect of it, and seeing that the Division 2 is having the expansion, Warlocks of New York, something like that. You guys know better.
Sure.
By the time
New York gangs, we'll call it that.
Yeah, sure. Exactly.
Sure, I know better.
Which continues. I would even if you guys don't care about the game at all, the game's fucking $3 right now, the standard game.
So can I expect a gift?
Wait, $3?
Literally, you can grab this game for $3.
Wait,
is this the PC? Standard game? No,
on PC. Oh,
it's on PlayStation 4, on Xbox One X, and also PC. You know, for $3, you get, you know, you get the standard game. Of course, they're doing that. I shouldn't come to anybody's surprise. You know, Bungie is giving Destiny 2 for free. Because the expansion is there, you know? And the idea is, let's get you the main game. Let's get you hooked on the main game. And then if you like it, you can go ahead and you know, maybe play the expansion and pay us like 30 or 40 or whatever is the amount. You know? So, at first I was like, wow, you know, why are they selling it so cheap? But then, of course. So I'm very looking forward to this particular game. I've heard that they have done... a revamp of the loot system, which they're making it a lot less confusing. Mm-hmm. You know, I never really liked the way that the divisions presented the, you know, its weapons and stuff like that, because you could tell that it was tailored for people that really like that kind of stuff, and I'm okay with that to a certain extent. But if I were to invite, for example, you, Mad Dog, if I were to invite you, you know, in it for you to see. You know, you might not care about, you know, all these numbers, you know, and symbols and what they represent and all that. That might not be, you know, it's kind of daunting when you see it at first, you know, like, wow, okay, so what does this mean? This weapon has like 7 type of different level. So, you know, something like that. Of course, I'm exaggerating. But now they make it very clear. Now they have actually simplified it to where, you know, your typical gamer, if interested on it, will know, you know, what they're getting into. You know, if the gear that you're getting is better than the gear that you have equipped and so on and so forth. And I had the opportunity to, and I have actually been playing it this week. Not the expansion, because that's, you know, not out. Or actually, it's out for whoever bought the year one pass, whatever.
Oh, the yeah, I got you.
I think I own it. Actually,
season?
You know what?
Oh, season pass or whatever.
It's kind of like a season, but like the year one pass. They're basically doing the same thing that Destiny and all those, you know, all the type of games are doing. So, but I was playing just the main game just to get a feel for it, because that was one game that, even though it was great, a lot of people abandoned it right after they got to the end game because it kind of got repetitive. So they are addressing that, and I don't mean addressing it with just the expansion. Of course, the expansion. You know, you have the expansion, but you also have, you know, the things that they're doing to keep it entertained after the expansion with, you know, the people that have been, that have looked at it so far, you know, there's some positive vibe there. But I left it. I reached the level cap and I finished the story and I was like, okay, I'm, you know, I thought I played a little bit of the end game. I never played the Dark Zone, but I didn't because I, you know, again, I very few people on the group actually play the game. I'm playing it on PC. So that's already niche enough.
Yeah.
And when they're available, I'm not there and vice versa. So it's not like a game that you pick up on. It's not like picking up Destiny on the console and, you know, everybody, there's always someone playing. You can always count on Ramiro to be there, you know?
Yeah. Shout out to Ramiro because he is a listener. Shout out.
Absolutely. So I picked it up and I was like, oh yeah, no, I kind of remember why I really, really like this, this game. I just wish they did something with the story, kind of like Bungie did at some point. They started caring a little bit more. Like, don't get me wrong, this one has the idea of the story is cool. It's just the way they present it is kind of bland and boring. Like, it doesn't really go. It doesn't get exciting. The way it's presented, it doesn't get exciting. Although, I did discover this morning that apparently this is old. But that if you have let's call it an Echo device, so that I don't activate the ones that I have here already. And you say the name of she who shall not be named. And you said, she who shall not be named. Of course, insert the name here. connect me to the Division network or something like that.
Oh, I did that.
You did that? So,
Mike, I had to stop it as it went on for so long.
It was, let me tell you, it pretty much gives you an info dump, but in the sense of like a you begin listening. You know, so it's basically trying, like, you almost wish that this is what they did on the game with the story, you know?
Yeah. I could almost imagine it as I heard it. I was like, you know, I remember playing the first one, and you had that feel of how empty the world was and how miserable it looked. And like, I could feel that through those messages. Yeah. And I thought about bullet sponges, and I was like, yeah, no, I'm good.
No, see, I'm glad you brought that up because I kind of got used to the bullet sponginess of the enemy, which is another thing that I hate admitting because I don't like the idea. Honestly, I don't. So in my mind, I have.
But
to
you like seeing those numbers pop up.
But I'm not exactly. Exactly. Is there something about seeing, oh, this weapon is actually taking a bigger chunk of their life.
Yeah, you know? It's like, oh, look at that. It's so satisfying.
So when they're far away, I can actually like pretend like, oh, well, my bullets are not hitting them. They're basically, when they die is when they get the one bullet that hits them, you know. But of course, it's hard to trick the mind to think the same way where you have them point blank and you're emptying a clip and they're still alive for some reason. It's right. Like, oh man, I wish it didn't happen as often. Let me just melee them because it's probably faster to kill them.
Faster, yeah.
Yeah. but yeah, man, I will dare to say I am fully back on board, and that's one of the reasons I want to finish Ritual of the Night. Oh, Bloodstain, sorry. So that I can go back into the treadmill of the Division 2, and I'm very excited about that. Warlocks of New York? Or I'm sure that's not the name of it. I'm sure that's not the name.
They're called the Jets. You guys are the... Oh, shit, what was the other name in West Side Story?
The West Side Story.
Oh, damn.
Warlords. Warlords of New York.
Warlords. Warlords of New York. Thank
there
you.
There it is.
Jesus Christ. Warlocks. Was I saying warlocks?
You were
I
saying.
I don't know. That's warlocks. A motorcycle game.
They're introducing magic, too.
Yeah, they sure are.
I almost want that to happen, believe it or not. Even though, fuck Tom Clancy. Freaking zombies.
The Warlocks is a motorcycle gang. You could introduce that into the Division.
There you go. That's right. That's right. You got the Rikers, the Cleaners, the motherfuckers, whatever.
Oh,
they
my mean. God. What an interesting gang.
Guys, it's $3. Come on. It costs less than your Starbucks mocha latte with whatever the hell.
Sir,
just grab it and put it there, and just to see, just to see your impression. I heard it has been. You know, it's a Ubisoft game. You know, fuck Ubisoft for everything else that they do, but they do know how to maintain their games, and they do know how to patch the living shit out of them. I mean, granted, it's because when they release, they're broken, but they do know how to fix it. These games are a year old already, so you can bet it's gonna be a good time. $3.
$3.
$3.
I can tell you right now that $3 is still too much. For me, I'm going to spend the $3. It's going to go in there. It's literally going to be put on the furthest back burner. And I'm never going to play it. So
who knows? You might have the experience that you have with Destiny. You finished the Destiny campaign.
Yeah. I just can't. I don't know sometimes, guys. All right, guys. So I've actually done a lot, believe it or not. Considering my life nowadays is, you know, being my job. My job, you know. I do want to say, Rook, I'm still playing Neo. And I'm still loving freaking Neo. I am still enjoying it. I don't even know how far I'm in it, but I have gotten pretty well into it. I am learning stuff as I go, which is...
Have you got it on the boat?
Have I gone on the boat? Yeah, I've gone on the boat. I'm on the second area like that. Oh, right,
so
now. Yeah,
all
yeah. Right,
so you passed me already. So. I got to the board. I was like, okay, I'm done. Fine.
Oh my god, dude, that's like the beginning, bro.
That's what everybody tells me.
Anyway, so yeah, so it is.
You have like a bunch, like at least a couple bosses.
You do have to go, yeah, yeah, yeah. I'm a few bosses past that already.
There you go.
So it's just a lot of fun. It's just weird things that I've been learning, little things that I just didn't know. I'm not switching to any other weapons. I'm just like, I am stuck with the chain and the ball
and chain.
That is
you're
the
stuck
one
with the ball and chain. The old ball and chain.
Yeah, the old ball and chain is the one that I'm taking all the way to the end. I've gotten really, really good at it.
I'm glad to hear that.
I figured out the some stupid shit that I walked into where I didn't even realize that I didn't know, which was I needed to complete tutorials in order to unlock some of the map for some of the moves and stuff. So I'm sitting here collecting ninja points and I'm going, when is this shit going to open up? You know? And it didn't dawn on me until I actually looked through the there's so as you if you haven't played Neo, basically you have some samurai moves, you have some ninjutsu type of moves, and then you have some sort of magic thing.
I've played it, so I'm gonna get something to drink. I'll be right back.
Okay. So basically,
well, you know what? I'm gonna just leave you alone. I'm gonna go get something to drink too. I'll be right. I'm just kidding.
What the hell? You guys are hilarious for the record. So anyway, what I was unlocking a bunch of samurai points and I was able to use that. I was unlocking a bunch of ninjutsu points, but I couldn't put any. I was like, what the fuck? Where is this? When is this thing going to unlock? And I realized that there are three tutorial missions that I need to actually do in order for those things to open up. And so here I am collecting a bunch of fucking ninjutsu points and not putting it into anything. So I'm actually a little bit proud of myself because I really wasn't using a lot of those items. But I was getting pretty far. And it wasn't until I just stumbled upon it when I actually stopped and read, hey, you need to complete this way of the whatever. And I'm like, fucking hell. So all this time, you know, I had like literally 25 ninjutsu points just sitting there doing nothing. And so little things like that where obviously the game doesn't really, you know, instruct you on what to do, but it's the discovery of some of these things that I'm enjoying. And I'm also realizing how much I'm liking the fact that I can open up a bunch of little weapons and stuff like that, but really the one weapon I need is the one weapon I have, and I've gotten really good at it. And so I'm really enjoying the hell out of that Neo, basically. And so I'm still digging through that, but in the meantime I have been able to actually play some other games and finish them. I finished Owlboy.
Owlboy,
which was actually a very, very good, I guess we can call it a side-scrolling shooter or action adventure game. Really, really well done.
It's a Metroidvania game.
Sure. I don't think it's a Metroidvania game, sir.
No, I don't think it is. Either.
But yeah, so it's really cool. It's not a very long game, but definitely enjoyable. I'm glad I spent like $10 or something like that on it. It was really, really good.
Nice.
Another game that I was able to play and complete, and this is the one I've been really wanting to say, is To the Moon.
Hold up. What? You should have actually started this.
No.
Oh, my God. All right.
I needed to drop it at the right point.
Sit down, Chaos. We're gonna talk about To the Moon over here. All right, sir. The floor is yours.
What am I witnessing?
When you get the chance, grab to the well. You're gonna hear. Biden talk about it. So, okay. Sir, you played To the Moon
and completed. Yes, To the Moon.
Where did you play it? What platform?
It's on my phone.
Oh, your phone. That's right. You bought it that day.
I actually have it on my PC. Believe it or not. Oh, excuse me, my laptop. Yeah. I actually have it on the computer, and I told you I started it at least five times, right?
Really?
Maybe about 20 minutes. I'm like, I just can't right now with this. Whatever is going on, I'm just like, it's not. In the first 20 minutes, I'm like, nope, it's not grabbing me. It's not doing it, right? And this time I had it on my phone, and And I want to say my wife was watching something on TV and I just really wasn't paying attention, but I was sitting there with her. So I was like, all right, let me take the time. I took it out, put my headset, my earbuds on, right, and just started to play it. And then once you get to a certain point, the point a little bit after the 20 minutes that I kept fucking doing, is when the intrigue starts and you're like, oh, okay. So for the record, To the Moon is it's a game that almost looks like an old school isometric RPG, very similar to Chrono Trigger, very similar to all those type of games, the way they used to look, right? But it is not an RPG at all, or it's not meant to be anything. It is literally what a walking simulator would be if it was made in that type of style. Okay, so and I don't mean to in any way make it sound less because of walking, but you're not really, there's no combat, there's no, maybe there's a little puzzle play, but it's nothing to the point. It's really just telling you a story, but it is a fascinating story. So basically, you control two scientists, or yeah, we'll say scientists, and they are tasked with, or their job is to give people their dying wish. But the way they do it is that they're able to go into their memories and sort of pull together from their memories and give to them what they want in the end before they go, right? And that's their overall their job, essentially. And so they go to this old man's mansion, and he's in a coma, but he's already paid for this in advance, and the whole thing was to have his wish was to go to the moon. Right, and that's hence the name of the game. And he
wanted to be an astronaut.
He just said he wants to go to the moon.
Oh, okay.
He never said he wanted to be an astronaut. That's all he said. And the problem was that the two scientists had to kind of go into to use his mind to go into some of his memories to talk to him to try to get, hey, why do you want to go to the moon? What's the leading factor? And for some reason, the mental projection of himself didn't have an answer for that.
Yeah.
and there lies the mystery. So like, okay, well, I guess we'll have to really go back in history in his memories to find out why, what the hell, what was it coming? Where did it come from, essentially? And so the way they go back, they constantly go back in time. So you kind of start as an older guy and work his way back to a young kid. Along the way, you learn about his life. I'm not going to, I really want to talk about it. I also don't want to spoil things. So I'm gonna be kind of loose with stuff,
yeah.
But along the way, this is pretty early on. He had a wife; she got sick and she passed away. And so as you're going back in time, there is the beauty of it is the way it's designed. The areas that you're walking around get smaller and smaller as you go back in time because the memory is small. If you really think about it, you can think about something that happened last week and you can kind of remember the room and everything that was going on. But if you try to think of something a few years ago, you only really remember what was around you at that moment, not everything else. Yeah. So that was a really well designed thing that they put in there. So I was like, okay, that makes sense as you're going into the, anyway. So you end up getting to when he's a young kid, and it's becoming more and more difficult for them to figure out because they still don't know at some point why he wants to go to the moon. And I'm not going to spoil anything from there, but the way they get there, first off, the game is simple in the way it looks and the way it plays. Again, there's not a lot involved, but the writing of the game is one of the best writings that I laughed as I'm playing this. And I was just like, and there's this particular song that plays throughout the game that is so memorable. And it's just a piano tune which plays consistently throughout. Not all the way, but you know what I'm saying? It comes up every so often as you're going through it. And the two characters you play, again, are extremely well written. They're very funny. They feel real, even though, you know, just the things that they say is just very something you would just say in your normal life when you're working with your coworker on something, you know? And then, of course, the story where it goes and the revelations that come out of it are really, really well worth it, considering the game probably took me, I don't know, two, maybe three and a half hours. It's not a long game, but it's really good. It's really, really, really good. And like I said, I needed to get past that 20 minute mark for it to finally sing it, because I don't know if it had to do with my laptop or the fact that I just played it on my phone. I don't know how to do with it, but I finally got through it all, so I can definitely, obviously, Santos has been recommend me play this game for forever, and I'm like,
Witcher 3. This is the Witcher 3 level of him trying to convince me to play it. And once I played it, I saw with my own eyes what he really meant. You know, that's the discovery that I wanted, because on point. It's a very simplistic game. It has Chrono Trigger type graphics almost. I wouldn't say isometric. I would say more like Chrono Trigger.
It's not overhead.
It's slightly slanted. Oh yeah. And the thing with, you know, with the for how silly the characters look, the dialogue makes it feel so grown up, so like out of that of that 16-bit look, you know, like you're like suddenly you're walking, you know, you're seeing the memories of this old man. And like you're really feeling for this old man, you know. It's like, you know, the life that he had. And it's almost like this would have made a really good movie, you know, if somebody could direct it properly.
Easily. Oh yeah. If they and it's not long, so it's long? Not. Yeah. You know, what I'm saying, it's if you perfect... can easily make it into a full feature length film, it's really really. They really thought out. Yeah. How not only the story, but how to deliver it, yes. Right? To deliver the pieces, right? Think of a film that has this intrigue, and it's the way it does that. It gives you these little pieces along the way, and sometimes you look at the piece and go, "I don't think this is important," but you hold on to it. And later on, you realize, "Holy shit, this is that piece they were talking about." I've been holding on to this entire time, and you realize how important it was to it. That type of thing, you know. And so, yeah, it's very good. I don't know how much it is on.
Oh, I think the normal price is like $4 or maybe $5, but
I literally got on the phone for $1.99, so I really paid $1.99.
Yeah. So it's not a new game, but even now the game was actually done in RPG Maker XP.
I was gonna say RPG Maker. I was thinking of the name of it. I was like, because there is an actual tool that you can license, or you can
purchase.
You can just make games, and people do, and there's actually a lot of them out there. So whoever did this,
that's a lot of games on Steam that are that, and that are really good RPGs, especially if you like that type of old school, you know, RPGs. Like, they're very well done, you know. But yeah, just like you said, this one, it even makes a jab at the fact that you're expecting it to be one of those type of games, but it's not.
Oh, in the beginning, yeah. It plays with honestly, and it happened. I was like, oh god, don't tell me this is what this. Because then, don't get me wrong, I don't mind those kind of games, but it's just nothing to that point led me to believe that was going to happen. So I was like, oh shit, are we really going to have to do this this turn-based RPG thing at this point? And then it plays, and then of course scientists is talking to the little kids, and the little kids are going, what are you doing? You know, because she's standing up saying, I'm about to cast something, and they're looking at, what are you doing? She's like, oh, I thought we were playing. You know, so I can't express how well written this the game is itself. And so yeah, so that's To the Moon, and it is officially challenge completed, guys.
Yes, I'm glad. I just want to see if it appears at some list in the future, like. Best old game or best, you know.
It might actually make it. Because it's up there. It's most certainly up there.
I still need to play because there are sequels, you know, for this. They have to do, you know, obviously with the characters. And I can't believe that I can, like, what am I doing? Like, I'm, you know what? I might just tonight.
just look that shit up and start.
So I can say, now I have a homework for you.
And I'll get to it in like six years.
Chaos, you need to, like, you got a PC, brother. You can play it on the phone. It doesn't matter.
That's
just
who?
You need Yeah. It, like, if you prefer not to have that, I mean, it don't matter. It just play it. Get a you have a good set of headphones. Also, I say headphones because this is a game that you definitely want to play. Want to have with you know.
And
with
it's free. Sound.
No.
It's like $1.99.
Yeah, on the phone it's $1.99. I think on PC it's maybe $5. Yeah. It's not going to be higher than that. By the way, I'm actually looking at my total play time here on my phone. It's 4 hours and 54 minutes.
Yeah, that's what it took me. It took me 5 hours to say probably close to that. Yeah.
And so it is again. That's To the Moon, and definitely one of the best old games right there for it. The next thing that I actually played, I'm still playing, and it's I finally picked up my Switch again, guys. I want to Switch. And of course, I'm not playing a freaking Nintendo game for the record. I started playing this little title that I actually have had on my list for a while to get. It's called Neo Cab. It's
Let me guess. So it's the character from Neo driving a cab.
There you go. Right? No.
On the nose, bro.
It's Neo Pets. So it's the pet grew up now.
And then you go around, like, you know, killing people with a chain and whatever or swords through the window and shit, right? Like, and you just, like, reenact.
I get it. Yeah. Because he's Neo. There you go. Nailed it.
Yeah.
Nailed it.
All right.
Well done, guys. Available now on Switch.
And PlayStation 6.
No. Neo spell N-E-O and cab. And so.
Okay. So let me take another time. So is the character Neo from The Matrix driving a cab?
It is.
Turning himself in The Matrix as a cab driver.
Correct. Yes, and it's neon and everything. Yes.
So that is it's a MMORPG.
A lot of cab driving games lately, apparently. Damn. Yes.
Hey, it's a cab driver started. No, is it taxi cab? Crazy taxi started it all.
Taxi.
Back in the day.
Taxi.
So, I promise. I'll let you finish.
No, you're fine. You're fine. what it's about, I've played probably a good 2-3 hours of it. I'm not even that that far, and I don't know how long it is. But basically, it is a story of this girl who is a cab driver, but it's in the future, and it has a very similar to Uber type thing. So basically, she's moving to a new city to meet her friend, and to basically she's leaving her life, and it's her best friend that she was separated for a while with, whatever. So you have it's a dialogue heavy game, but you get passengers. Who come in, right? Because you got to make money and you're in the city, so you kind of got to drive to different locations. It all takes place from the view of, think picture a camera on top of the hood of the car facing into the car. That's almost completely the entire game is here, is in that view. And she's in the front seat.
Say that again?
The view from the game is almost completely from the view. Picture the camera sitting on top of the hood of the car facing into the car. That's basically the view you're seeing most of the time. So you get a lot of – so because you're needing the money, you also you have to – the conversation you have to have or have to be well done. You don't want to insult the passenger. You don't want to have
– How do you drive?
You don't drive. It drives.
It's not about that. Driving,
you're not talking. You're not actually controlling it. It's all about the dialogue. It's all about the story. Her friend ends up missing, so now we're kind of looking for her. But at the same time, she's having to still do her job, right? You still have to do that. So it's actually pretty good. The music is actually pretty cool. It's very synth, very 80s synth music. Obviously, it's very neon city as well. It's interesting. Like I said, it's been on my list for a little bit, and I'm still playing it. So I don't know. I don't really know where the story is going. So that's all I know so far. That a friend got there. They meet up, and it's been so long, and they had like a falling out. But you know, she had to come back. She came back, and they made up, and now she's missing. And that's essentially the story. But it's pretty cool. I'll probably post a trailer for you guys so you can kind of see that one, because you kind of need to see it to kind of know what's going on it.
I think I've seen the trailer, actually, especially when you reminded me of that.
Short black hair in the front. But anyway, it doesn't matter. So the point is, that's Neo Cab, and I'm still into it. That's really all I've played, although that may not sound, making that sound like not a lot, but it's a lot.
Hey, listen, you play To the Moon. You have satisfied your quota as far as I'm concerned.
Listen, in adulthood, you played a lot, man.
An adult. Yeah, that's actually like, what were you doing? You know,
well, this
did
is
you even work?
You freaking no lifer.
Yeah.
Here I am questioning Dark, and here. Yeah. Oh man, so I did see one movie, and I saw it's actually a Netflix film, and this is probably the oddest animated film I've ever seen, and yet also one of the ones that left me just really, really thinking afterwards. It is called I Lost My Body. And so it's
that got me thinking right there. Yeah, already.
I Lost My Body. So it basically it stars a hand. So the beginning of the story, and you can see this in the
trailer. Like a joke.
I know. It's one of those things where this sounds like a ridiculous joke or ridiculous story, but it's one of those. The more you watch it, you start seeing it. So basically, it's a severed hand, and the severed hand is like in a fridge or something like that, and ends up becoming sentient. Yeah, and now it's missing its body. Right, and it escapes from the thing, and little bit is trying to get out, and it gets out into the city.
What?
yes, exactly.
What?
Gets into the city, and oh, by the way, the city is Paris, so it's all takes place in Paris, and well, then it's basically right trying to go back to its body. Right, a parallel story to that is this young Middle Eastern kid who's living in Paris, and he is a pizza delivery guy, and things don't work out, and anyway, it goes back and forth between these two characters, right? Immediately, this is not a spoiler. Immediately, you can recognize the mole that's on the kid's hand, also the mole that's on the sentient hand, right? You know, the hand that's trying to get back to its body. So clearly, this leads to something that happens to the hand.
Yeah.
I'm not gonna go into the story on it, but man, this movie was way better than I in any way anticipated.
How long is this movie?
It's probably an hour and 20 minutes. It's not even that. It's not even really long. Again, it's a Netflix film. It is a winner, by the way, for Sundance or something like that, or it was animated.
Oh, there you go.
And so I think it got nominated for Golden Globe or something like that. Anyway, the point is, I saw it on Netflix. Like, you kind of passed by, and I was like, "Oh shit, what the hell is this?" And then you let the trailer play, and it was like, "That's just the oddest thing in the world." Then you watch it, and let me tell you, the character, the hand itself becomes such a character. You know what I mean? It's like at some point you're fearful for the character because it's going through hell, you know what I mean? Just try to get back to its body. And think about it for a second. If you're the size of just your hand and you're going through the streets of an urban city, the craziness you can get into, you know? And you're constantly hiding because obviously you're a hand. You can't, you know, people are going to freak out. They start seeing a hand. So it's just so odd. I don't even know how to explain it. It's the way it's done is such a weird but awesome premise, and the story by the end is one of those that I sat there after the credits and I was just like,
what the hell did I just watch?
Yeah, it's like,
so let me get it straight. A disembodied hand
he's still trying to get this.
It's making its way back to its own body.
Yes.
Yeah, what's that all about that? I don't think anything.
This is some Adam's Family shit right here.
I mean, right? What is it? Thing.
Oh, it was played by Thing, you know, from the Adam's Family. That was,
so that's
was the actor.
Thing. Well, Thing came back to act, is what you're saying. After all these years, he finally came back.
If Rick Moranis can do it, so can Thing.
Right? Exactly.
I agree.
Ain't that a thing?
Yeah, I think it's a thing.
There you go. Thing came back, and now that's a thing.
Also, the on a side note, the animation of it is also very, very good.
It
that's a weird thing. It's weird because at the very beginning, it's like it goes from a certain angle, and you're like, "So wait, are we looking through the hand's eyes?" So it's like it doesn't make sense. But at some point, you know what it is. At some point, it doesn't matter. Like, at some point, you just say, you know what, I accept it. Let's just go on. And when you just let it happen, it's like, It's weird because I know how stupid this actually sounds. You know what I mean?
Actually, it doesn't sound stupid at all. It sounds like my next movie.
It sounds like somebody took a really, really nice trip.
Yeah. On top of that, yes. But it is a shock.
So looking at their hand and like, what would happen if?
That's a thing throughout the film as well. So, but yes, that is I Lost My Body. It is available now on Netflix, one of my favorite animations so far. And that, guys, is all that I have been doing.
Psych, because I have another thing that I forgot to mention.
Okay.
My bad.
Okay, Chaos, go ahead.
Speaking about trips, I watch Bad Boys for Life.
Bad Boys for Life.
What is your reaction, sir? Because I haven't watched it yet, but I want to.
I saw the trailer, and I was just like, oh my God, this smells like shit.
Yeah, I know. I'm not going to lie. I agree.
Well, gentlemen, I will just go ahead and say it.
It is shit. No.
This movie was actually pretty good.
Really?
I'm not going to lie. I enjoyed it a lot more than I thought that I was going to. Considering I liked the Bad Boys movies. They're for what they were. I was never like a huge fan or anything like that. Like, I didn't ask for this movie or was hoping for, you know. I knew that I didn't remember enough because I'm the type of person that I usually watch movies once and then that's it. I don't need to rewatch them. I was hearing a lot of good vibe about this one. So I was like, yeah, well, you know, maybe my wife would be interested. And then I realized my wife hasn't seen it. Hasn't seen the Bad Boy movies. I'm like, really?
None of them. Oh, shit.
She hadn't. So I'm like, well, we need to address this because I can use a refresher.
Just because we like them doesn't mean they're actually good. Your wife just has good taste.
Yeah, true, probably. Yes. Yeah. She probably avoided it. No, that's because she was thinking like, it's one of those like buddy cops, you know, type of movies, and like there's plenty of those. And she's right. There's a lot.
You know, wrong. But this is Michael Bay.
I know. This is Michael Bay.
Well, this one isn't Michael Bay.
No,
is it?
Okay. Not this one. Yeah, the previous one, and I went through watching it, and you know what's funny is I remember seeing Bad Boys 2, but I didn't remember it, so it felt like the first time again.
Oh my God!
At least with Bad Boys, I remember a lot of the scenes, but with Bad Boys 2, I was like, "Did I really watch this? I know I did. I must have. It's Bad Boys."
I'm not gonna lie. I quote those movies way more than I really should.
Yeah. Well, I think if you like them for what they were, this is another one that I think you'll be pleased because it for not being Michael Bay-ish, any shows, you know, there's definitely
less explosions.
I will say, yeah, definitely a lot less crotch shots. I'll give you that. You know, yeah. You know, right. Although there was at least one, maybe if I remember correctly, there it had the typical like camera around the characters in slow motion, that's already a token of Bad Boys, so of course they're gonna do it on every movie.
Of course,
but it didn't feel the same. Actually, it didn't even.
Is there
feel
a bunch
the same.
Of chicks in like bikinis or something at some point?
Not as overt, you know. Overt. No.
No Michael Bay levels of.
Not underage crotch shots or anything crazy like that either. No, it was pretty tasteful on that sense. That's why. It's my second favorite Bad Boys. I still like the second one better.
Oh my God. It's just... okay. You're right. I enjoy them because they're entertainment. They're at the same level as the Fast and Furious movies. They're just entertainment because they're just so goddamn out. No, they're just completely out there. It doesn't matter how you look at whichever franchise you look. They're both out there as hell.
Yeah. I'll grant you that. I don't care about Fast and the Furious movies.
I don't blame you.
Kind of stupid, but
I don't blame you.
But I can definitely see the value of, hey, if you're entertained, if you want to be entertained, definitely watch this movie. It's not like it's gonna have its time where it's gonna make you laugh, you know. But it's not gonna be hilarious. It's gonna have its action scenes. It's gonna have its moments that are gonna have you on the edge of your seat because you're like, oh fuck, what's gonna happen? But it never at the point of, yo, this is one of the best movies or anything like that. And to be honest with you, the reason I didn't like it that much is because I don't like movies where they bring Spanish speaking characters. Mm-hmm. For some reason, the Spanish speaking characters are supposed to speak Spanish on their script, right? But they forget how to speak normal Spanish and they sound so hokey and ridiculous. Like they have
so unnatural.
So yeah. Unnatural that it's like, what the fuck is this language? It's like, this is not the way that any Spanish person speaks, not even on a soap, on a Spanish soap opera. And I can tell you that because one of the actresses that appeared there was a famous actress from Spanish soap operas. But like you see it here, and it's like, nobody talks like that. Oh my gosh, shut up. Just speak English and just dub it, then it's better than to hear you speak terrible Spanish. And I don't mean like Spanglish or anything like that. No, I mean like you're trying to pass this as a normal person will speak Spanish, and it just sounds ridiculous. It sounds like you literally took the words in English and you passed it through Google Translator. Mm. You know, it's bad. It's terrible. So, and also it goes into, you know, something that obviously I'm not going to spoil, but it kind of gets ridiculous to the point where I was like, the only reason I accepted it was because, well, the stakes, you know, there's not much here. It's one of those movies. Of course, it's going to get crazy and bombastic and ridiculous with the story. I mean, look at what's happening to Fast and the Furious. It's becoming Avengers now, evidently. So it's like, who cares? You know, you're just there to be entertained. And I will guarantee fucking to you that you will be entertained by the movie. In no way I'm saying skip it.
If you want to look at ridiculousness, look at Bad Boys 2 when they drive that Hummer down the mountain.
I still find that movie. Three was good. I would say all of them are the same level and entertaining, but like I feel like 2 edges them out a little bit. You know, and I like 1 because, what is the original? And 3, I like because for a character, like obviously they're older. I can relate to that. I'm older, you know? So they're starting to act like the way that, you know, that you kind of expect them, or maybe a little bit. But it's still like the chemistry they for it not being a Michael, you know, the same, you know, and directors and stuff like that, they still managed to keep have that feeling. That same, yeah, to keep that same
chemistry
between the characters and, you know, the story, and it was fun. I had a good time. I left that movie theater smiling, you know. But I'm not gonna push anybody into a movie theater to watch it. Let's put it that way.
Good, because I'm not gonna see it in the theater. I will probably watch it.
You know what? You don't deserve to watch it then. Like that.
I'm not gonna watch it. Well, I was thinking of watching it in the movie theater, but at this rate, I won't. So,
yeah. I didn't say what part did I say? It sounded bad.
It's not. So you're saying, so just from what you said, it seems to have kept the feeling and the whatever
it's gonna have the car chases. It's gonna have
You seem to like part 2
a little bit.
Yeah. A little bit more. And for me, since I didn't really care for part 2, this one is apparently not as good as part 2. You know what I mean? It leaves me with...
You like the first one then?
Huh? I liked the first one.
I liked it too, but I think I like the villain of part 2.
Did I ever tell you guys it's the first movie I saw that actually cursed a lot?
Yeah.
Oh, really?
Wow, yes. Really? That was your first R-rated?
I don't think it was the first already, but it was the first one that just said fuck every other word, you know?
Yeah. There you go. Yeah, you just kicked us out of YouTube. Thank you.
All right, guys. That's all we've been doing. We'll be right back.
So the French Dispatch. At first I'm watching this, you know, it feels kind of normal. Like, all right, it seems kind of like one of these frou-frou movies that Matt was wearing. Like, you know,
there it is. Cool.
But that's Bill Murray, so you definitely piquing my interest here.
there's a little movie known Lost in Translation that kind of turned me off to Bill Murray doing weird shit.
I mean, wasn't that supposed to be a good movie?
It was supposed to be. It kind of failed in that simple turn.
It was a very good movie. And
well, that's what I thought. Okay, so this is a personal taste thing. Okay.
It's okay to be wrong. This movie was horrible. This movie was offensively bad.
Oh wow!
not this one. Not the French. The French
super unpopular opinion here.
Yeah, no.
Austin's translation was an absolute garbage movie.
Yeah, exactly. See, someone understands me.
Oh no, I'm just quoting you. That I haven't watched the movie yet.
That's fine.
Apparently, I will, because either it's the greatest movie ever or the worst movie ever.
I know you have a 50-50 chance.
My expectations are everywhere.
May I suggest, and I really can't believe it, because let me tell you, for the most part, every time, you know, now it tells me, dude, this is a hit. I watch it, and without a doubt, it's a fucking hit. I love it. I'm down. But sometimes, at least a couple of times already have happened, he'll say, bro, this is a hit, and I watch it, and I'm like, I'm waiting for the punchline. At some moment, I'm waiting for him to come and jump in and say, fool you, psych.
So your face of utter confusion is just like, what? What is happening?
I think, what was that? There was one movie that I saw that I wanted to text him at like 2 in the morning. I think I might have actually. I mean, like, what the hell,
man? It follows, man.
It follows. Yeah, I was so angry because, like, I invited my wife to watch this. You know?
She didn't like it either?
No.
So, first off, funny story, guys. Funny story time. By the way, we are back. This is all included in the podcast.
Yes. Oh, really?
This is uncut. We'll get to the trailer in the week in a second, but I want to tell a funny story here. So, and I'm going to post this trailer on the show notes, because you have to see it to understand why this is.
If you can understand.
So there was a movie called Black Dynamite. Has anybody heard of it?
I feel like I've heard of it.
So it is. So you know about blaxploitation films of the 70s. Right. Right. Yes, so this was like Shaft and all that. So this was an actual movie that came out probably 5-6 years ago, something like that. But it was made to look and feel like a blaxploitation film. The main character was played by, is it Michael J. White, who played Spawn? Mm-hmm. You should know. I'm waiting for an affirmative.
Yes.
Okay. He was in shock. He already spotted. He went to shock.
I think I lost him for a second there.
You know, I mean, seriously, you're. I mean, out of all the movies, you Spawn. Okay.
You have to know who that is, right?
Of course. I own the Blu-ray. It's a terrible movie.
There it is. So he plays the main character called Black Dynamite, which is a kung fu fighting badass mofo type of, you know what I mean? And it plays around with a lot of stuff. It's got
It's Michael J. White.
Yeah, it's got a lot of, it has a lot of sex, it has a lot of violence. But it's humorous to watch, right? So I tell a friend about this, right? And I was like, dude, you really should check this out, man. It's really, really good. My friend who I'm referring to is, like, very white, you know what I mean? So and so I tell him, and I mean that to say that, you know, there are things I can't discuss with him because
he's so white he would agree with you on how white he is.
Yes, uh-huh. he would. He's just very, oh gosh, and I don't know how to explain it without making it sound worse, to be honest with you. But the point is. So I told him, dude, you need to check this movie out, you know. And we discuss movies, and he gets stuff. And so I'm like, okay. So he takes, for whatever reason, when I told him about the movie, uh-huh. he takes as a, okay, I'm going to watch this with my wife and son.
Oh, my God. With his family?
Oh, my God. And then later on, he messages me later. Oh, yeah. He messages me later, and he's like, so, dude, this movie. and I'm like, yeah, what'd you think? He goes, well, I liked it, but I guess I probably should have asked more questions before.
What movie it was? Oh, Black Dynamite. Oh my God, really?
I probably should have asked more questions before I have my mother-in-law, my in-laws, you know, with me.
And we watched it over Thanksgiving dinner. Thank you.
And they lived in Pittsburgh. And you know, his wife is Jewish, and you know, she comes from a Jewish family. I about died laughing because I was just like, no, dude, what part of that movie explanation did it sound like you can have your wife involved?
Family friendly movie, of course.
Oh my God, that's hilarious.
That was something for them, you know. And I apologize. I was like, dude, he enjoyed it still. He enjoyed it for, you know, the movie, buddy. So anyway, that was the story I wanted to share.
That was great. That was absolutely great.
To be fair with you, Matt, though, my wife has done the exact, well, not that, but my wife has done the thing where she would tell me, oh, I think you will love this movie. And then I'll finish watching it with her and I will look at her like, what part of this movie did you think I was going to like? Like, where was it?
What part of this did you think I was going to love?
Did we watch the same movie? Like, I don't even like the subject matter. Like, do you even know me, wife?
Oh, my God. So, guys, it is now time for Trailer of the Week.
Trailer of the Week.
Trailer of the Week, guys, is this little tale of a newspaper they call the
Black French... Dynamite.
Black Dynamite. Black Dynamo. No. Maybe I should say that it's the movie's called The French Dispatch. Which is a story of specifically the French Dispatch is a newspaper in like Kansas or something like that. Anyway.
Kansas?
Yeah, yes.
Wait, this place what? In Kansas?
Did you not take a look at, you guys really weren't watching?
No,
I was so convinced that this was in France. I didn't even
I swear, me too.
I'm like, why are they talking so American? Whatever.
I didn't even notice that. Anyway. So
I was like, there's no accents here, but I guess they didn't care. So why should I?
This took place in Kansas.
So that makes so much more sense now.
Now it makes sense. Okay, good.
Well, a little bit more sense.
So,
which doesn't say much.
The reason why I've mentioned this before, that there are certain directors that I don't care what they do, I'm going to go see this movie, right? Quentin Tarantino's one that comes to mind. There are very few. Quentin Tarantino, Alfonso Cuarón, they make a movie, I'm there. I don't care what it is, I'm in. You have my $10, $12, whatever it is, I'm going to go watch it. Alfonso Cuarón, he did Skyfall. So he did Children of Men. He did a couple. He did Gravity with Sandra Bullock. Another one is Christopher Nolan. He's doing Tenet. I don't care. I don't know what it is, but Christopher Nolan has my money, you know?
Yeah.
So this particular, though, I get it. This is not the same kind of director. I get it. But this particular director, Wes Anderson, is another director. And yes, he falls squarely in the frou-frou end of things. Right?
In the Cannes winner
Cannes Film Festival side of the Chaos was there for our film of the decade, and number four on my film of the decade was A Grand Budapest Hotel, and that was a Wes Anderson film.
Sure, that movie, everybody knows that movie. To all the one of you that may have seen or even heard of that movie before,
I'm telling you, man, you're too good for this world. No. I think this is the type of movie that
I almost agree with that.
No. You need to have a brain to be able to enjoy it. And you know us, we don't have.
I guarantee guarantee, I will literally pay you guys, I will bet you guys money that you will watch the Grand Budapest Hotel and you will like it. You may even love it, but you will definitely walk away liking it. Okay. It is a very different type of film. It's the same. The way this trailer looks and plays is very similar. Here's what I will definitely say about the marketing of what Wes Anderson said. He does not like sharing information. So when you look at that trailer, you walk away with, so I kind of think I know what's going on. But not
so
entirely.
They're friends?
Yeah, I kind of think I know what's going on. But the film is not going to leave you like that. It's not going to be. It's not going to be a story you're not going to be able to understand.
Let me ask you this. Let me ask the both of you this. How about if we make plans to go watch this movie, the three of us?
I'll be fucking down.
Yeah. I already paid for it, so. it's done.
Buy the ticket so that we can sit, so we all sit there, and I'm going to cash you the money right now.
Yeah.
Wait, you already bought the tickets?
No, I'm just saying I'm already
Like, damn, did you like pre-order that shit already?
No. Yes, he did.
This is not that kind of this is not an Avengers level event.
Oh, okay. All right.
They don't have
there will be seats, don't worry.
Yeah, we may just be the only ones there for the record.
Yeah, there you go.
We'll own that
or
shit.
Maybe surrounded by a bunch of old folks, but that's one of the two things are gonna happen there. Anyway, guys, The French Dispatch has a laundry list of freaking actors. I don't know that's because when it comes to Wes Anderson films, people want to be part of his films. So you have Elizabeth Moss, you may know her, Lea Seydoux, which is you just mentioned a Fragile.
Oh, Fragile actress from Death Stranding.
That's right. Bill Murray, of course, is in it. Edward Norton is
also from Death Stranding.
Who, Bill Edward Murray. Norton?
Bill Murray is in Death Stranding?
No, he's not.
He might as well.
I mean, sure. That's definitely news right there.
So Edward Norton, William Dafoe, Christoph Waltz, Liev Schreiber, Owen Wilson, Adrian Brody, Benicio Del Toro.
From Death Stranding.
Angelica Houston. The list goes on. I mean, Henry
Winkler. The list. Keep going.
I can mention. You may not know some of these, but I can mention some of these. Rupert Friend, Francis McDormand, Jeffrey Wright, Jason Schwartzman, Henry Winkler. I was just mentioning. I'm sure you know who Henry Winkler is. The Fonz.
Yeah.
Okay. Anyway, the point is, it is his. They're actors who will just go to him to I want to be in it, even if it's for 5 minutes. You know, even if it's this tiny little role, I want to be in it. So that's why. And the stories are always very, the way he frames his shots, they're always very square.
I was going to ask you. I was like, is that 4x3?
It is 4x3. Yes, it is 4x3. He doesn't always do it in 4x3, but in this one, he's apparently doing it. In the Grand Budapest Hotel, there's certain different time periods. So when you're in it's weird because when you're in the almost closest present, you have the widescreen. As it goes back to another one, it goes a little bit short. And then when it goes back into the furthest time, it's like just this box. You know what I mean? And so he plays around with that. Anyway, I don't know if my two co-hosts agree with me.
No, hey, I'm super down.
I want to see it. It looks very interesting, even though it's out there.
Which obviously is not going to be the case, but this movie could suck right now, and we have had so much fun already with it that it already makes it worth it, the ticket price.
There you go. That is the French Dispatch, or Dispatcher, depending on
when does
on
it come
you.
Out?
It comes out. Oh shit! I just lost it. Hold up.
It's already out.
Right. Oh shit! It's out there now. No. it comes out July 24th is the expected release date at the moment. So
there
this summer.
For my birthday, we can go.
July 24th. Yeah.
That's not my birthday, but we can go.
Yeah, we'll call it your birthday. Why not?
Yeah, exactly.
All right, guys. Let's get into the useless news that you can use. I am going to go ahead and start with some useless news here, guys.
Oh, thank God, because I wasn't ready.
Okay. All right. You know what? I'm not actually ready either. Hold on.
All right. Then I'll take this up. There you go.
There you go.
For the save, sir.
And I'm going to read this off The Verge, because apparently just coming for my news. Why not? EA reassigns future Need for Speed projects to burnout developer Criterion Games.
Oh, wow.
So wait.
Okay, yeah. No, go ahead and do that.
We are going... questions. I mean, we're just going to get another burnout feeling Need for Speed, apparently.
That's what it sounds like to me. Well,
that's what we were hoping, but we're not going to get that.
I mean, it's going to be riddled with microtransactions.
Right, well, first of all, we want an actual burnout game, not a burnout game with a Need for Speed skin on it.
How about that, right? You are absolutely right.
I can agree. Yeah. I can agree.
I mean, honestly, there's really not much more to say other than that, but I wanted to bring that up first.
I wanted to ask, because my understanding was that Ghost Games were handling the Need for Speed franchise. So does it say then, or it's just going to be like a 1 year they're going to be, it's going to be Criterion, the next year it's going to be Ghost Games, or what's going on? Because I thought it was all them.
Yeah, I'm trying to see if I read this here, but I don't.
Doesn't really go into detail.
No. It just says Ghost Games took over Need for Speed in 2013 with a release of Need for Speed Rivals, which was garbage, which was received well. Sure, the cars are sweating all the time. Great game. But the next two games were met with mixed reviews. The most recent installment, Need for Speed Heat, has fared a bit better, though. And that's all it says about Ghost Games.
All right.
Okay, Rival Ghost Games released. Let me see. Last game in the franchise. Okay, so I guess they have it on the back burner. I don't know. Who knows? But good for them. I mean, I Criterion knew how to make, good racing games. And granted, we haven't had a, good one of those super arcade-y, crazy go nuts games since Paradise City. So bad that we actually got a re-release of Paradise City not too long ago. Yeah. So, but like,
I'm not gonna lie, I didn't like the Criterion Need for Speed games.
You did not?
Nope.
Okay. Which ones were they? Because I feel the same. I feel like there hasn't been an exciting Need for Speed game since Hot Pursuit. Remember Hot Pursuit?
Yeah, no, you and I played Hot Pursuit.
Yeah.
Was that Criterion though? I'm not sure. Maybe that's
2010's Need for Speed Hot Pursuit and 2012's Need for Speed Most Wanted.
There you go.
Which are some of the more popular installments, apparently.
So there. I mean, I've always liked the idea of Hot Pursuit ever since, olden times when they actually did Hot Pursuit. So I like the, you play as a cop, or you play racers or whatever. Like, that game happened, it was great, but they never did it again, or they tried to, but they kind of messed up the formula. I don't know.
Listen, okay, to me the best Need for Speed, or one of the best Need for Speed game, was the original Need for Speed Most Wanted that had the BMW M3 in the cover.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, remember that? That's the Xbox 360 era.
Yeah. And I absolutely love that game. Right, and one of the key things that made that game so incredible was the cops.
Yeah,
you couldn't skip them. Okay, if they were chasing you, you couldn't fast travel. You couldn't go into the garage. You had to escape before you could do anything else. And that there was this sense of tension all the time, because you couldn't get busted, because if you got busted three times, you lost that car.
Mm-hmm.
Right? It got impounded.
Yeah, that was
pretty... On later installments, like the immediate one was Carbon, you could literally skip the cops. If you were being chased, you could just fast travel to a race or whatever, and it didn't matter. Yeah. And, it was things like that. And then later on, with the customization being, it was kind of less. It got less, and time went on for whatever reason. And
They never recaptured that excitement of,
the direction they went turned me off.
Yeah, I agree.
I think you nailed it. It's they have this good run around the, you know, the 360 PS3 era. Like they never recapture that Need for Speed excitement, you know, because those games were, I mean, that was an annual game, you know, at some point, and they shat the bed,
typical fashion, yeah.
And then they took him out of commission for 2 years. They came back after 2 years with Need for Speed, whatever, because that might as well have been the name, because nobody cared about it. And then they went into a hiatus again. It's like, what's going on?
Yeah.
You know?
Like, the Need for Speed that's Underground, Need for Speed Underground was amazing. Need for Speed Underground 2, yeah. I love it, but some of the customizations was a little ridiculous, but that was the point of it. Like, well, I don't know, you could put like 1,000 speakers in your car with like screens and shit and like all of these lights and whatever was completely unnecessary, but fuck it, it was cool, yeah. You know? And on Most Wanted, they cut back on a lot of that customization, but they made up for with other things. So, I don't know. Let's see what happens with the Need for Speed license now.
Yeah.
I really do like, I used to enjoy those games a lot. You know, those were my arcade racing games that I went to.
Need for Speed Burnout. There you go. I just sold the idea to EA. Actually, I gave it away, but fuck it. I want a good one of those without all the microtransaction BS. Which,
of course, oh my god, yes. Then of course it got worse with all that crap.
You know. No. I'll take the next one because I have. Well, guys, I have some bad news for you guys. Unfortunately, a moment of silence for E3. E3 has passed away. Unfortunately. Sorry. I am obviously exaggerating. Well, right now, E3 is in critical condition. E3 host Geoff Keighley bows out of the show, criticizes event's direction. This is coming from Kotaku. Rumors of Nintendo's possible absence from this year's E3 has proven to be unfounded. But doubts are still swirling around the 2020 edition of the gaming signature mid-July Hype Festival in Los Angeles. Earlier today, longtime E3 participant Geoff Keighley announced that he wouldn't be involved with the show this year. And, I mean, not having Sony is already a blow, all right? But not having Geoff Keighley, bro.
The Keighley's missing, man. I don't know.
I'm canceling my PTO. There's no reason for E3 anymore to exist. I mean, what do I care about? No Xbox Series Y, Z, double A, triple X. You know, what's the point? Keighley's not there.
Or just call it Sexbox like Angry Joe does.
There you go. This is the tweet he announced. He said, I've made a difficult decision to decline to produce E3 Colosseum. He announced on Twitter, referring to a series of live stream developer interviews he has put together for the last few years. For the first time in 25 years, I will not be participating in E3. Keighley had attended every E3 since the show began. I didn't know that, actually. Mm-hmm. He's a staple. Oh my god, this news.
So was Sony.
It hurt. Sony started. Yeah, so was Sony. Exactly. I think E3 needs. This is still his quote. I think E3 needs to become more digital and global. Oh, I don't agree with that, Keighley. Come on, he said in a Twitter reply to someone about asking about his decision. It's a brand that means a lot to people, but shouldn't be just a show floor. He didn't elaborate further on what he thought E3 was doing wrong. The Entertainment Software Association, the industry group that runs E3 each year, didn't provide many clues themselves. In a press release issued after Keighley's announcement, the group noted that this year's show, quote, will feature special guest gamers, oh boy, celebrities, oh boy, and digital programming on the show floor while connecting with global audiences throughout extended live streaming. A highlight will be the debut of an all-new floor experience that will be stream to bring exclusive conversations with leading industry innovators and creators to attendees and fans worldwide. I can't read any more of this. I mean, this is an E3 that is meant to be an exciting E3 because this is the announcement of, you know, this is it. This is the one where they show, you know, the next generation consoles, right? So here we are at the cusp of a new generation, and we got, you know, companies and now the main host basically being like, nah, it's fine. We really don't need to be done like this. Hey, which I understand. Don't get me wrong. I understand the point. Although I still don't understand Sony's decision this year. I understood it last year. But this year, it makes no fucking sense for them to be doing this. I'm sorry. Because this is the year that they could have actually got... like, Microsoft's been like, oh, yeah, we're going to be there. You know, we're going to be there. And, of course, they had the show prepared and all that. Until I hear Sony saying, we're not going to E3, wink, wink, but we're going to have something around that time. You know, it doesn't make sense. It doesn't make sense.
I mean, for them
this year. Last year, I completely understand. Actually, I was kind of glad on the retrospect, thinking about it. It's like, okay, Sony, the previous year, you did a lot of hoopla, but you didn't really have a lot to show. The stuff that you show was already, we have already seen. Last of Us is still not released. Last of Us 2 is still not released to this day. 2 years after the last time that you made the whole, your whole floor press conference, you know, about it, because you had it in that stupid tent or whatever. And I wasn't gonna, you know, like, it looked like they had less, understandably so. Because PS5, bro, PS5 2020, and here's 2020, and they're like, nah, it's cool. We don't need to be there.
The,
that kind of pisses me off.
The honestly, I don't know.
Not the next word.
Yeah, honestly, I mean, not having Sony there, yeah, that's kind of a bummer. If they have something else around the same time,
I'll be cool with
know,
that.
It, cool. It would, you know, it's
I was
like,
expecting
okay.
it.
Yeah, and I'm pretty sure they will. I'm pretty sure. I mean, I have no
idea. I don't know what to believe anymore.
Well, my next my piece, guys, is actually we're going to keep it on the Sony topic since we're here. Sony is struggling with costly parts driven by high demand for memory components that could drive the price of the PlayStation 5 to around $500.
Oh, boy. $599.
This is according to a report from Bloomberg. The current manufacturing cost of the PS5, Bloomberg says, is around $450. Competition for DRAM and NAND flash memory are said to be driving up costs, but Bloomberg also reports that Sony is using an especially expensive cooling system for the PlayStation 5. A common complaint about the current generation console, the PlayStation 4, is a loud fan due to heat dissipation.
True story.
Indeed. Bloomberg says that Sony is taking a wait-and-see approach, meaning they're waiting to see how much Microsoft prices their Series X before setting a price on the PlayStation 5. But if Sony follows a similar pricing model for PlayStation 5 as it did the launch of PlayStation 4, a price of $499 for PlayStation 5 seems possible, if not very likely. When Sony unveiled the first details of PlayStation 5 last year, the console sounded more expensive than the $399 PlayStation 4, but the company said it was targeting an appealing price point based on the PlayStation 5's feature set. So, what do you think, guys? How do you feel about a $499 price?
Well, I think Sony's in a position where they could get away with it, but it's because when you think about it, PlayStation 4 had no fucking business costing $399. That was easily a $499 machine when it came out. You know that for what it was doing, right? Of course, it would have been brought down later on in price, but debuting as $399 was amazing. I could wish that they would repeat the same thing. But reading, and I was hoping that was going to be the case. But reading the news and delving a little bit into it and knowing the components, you know, the NAND flash, which is, you know, what they're going to be using for the solid state, that has come down in price, but that's still pricey. And the problem is these are the same components that every freaking phone out there, you know, it's asking for and asking in big numbers. So there's only a certain amount of factories of foundries that could actually maintain, you know, allocate, you know, chips towards all these companies. So of course it's going to be expensive, and to expect it to be a $399 again will be unrealistic. So $499, yes, it is pricey. I will be disappointed, but I would expect it at that point for what it's bringing me. And they're talking about expensive cooling solution, which almost makes me think of, well, what the Xbox did with the vapor chambers and crap. That thing, it's amazing, but it is pricey also. So yeah, it'll still be day one for me. That's what it is. This is fucking PlayStation. I mean,
I agree with that sentiment. I kind of expect the $499. All along, I was kind of expecting it. When I read that they were expecting it, I was like, really? Because just by the specs and everything, like, it read expensive.
Yeah.
You know?
Well, so did the PS4, though. And look at what they did. I mean, they just really wanted to fuck Microsoft.
Yeah. They're like, that was literally the dagger.
So, you know what I mean? Because,
yeah, that particular, my God, that was such a freaking, that was one of the memories. Yeah,
they had a goal.
We're going to have that this time.
They had a mission, and they went out to execute.
They executed Order 66.
They sure freaking did. And this is not the first time, guys. The first time they did this was on the very first E3. This is not a... So don't also... I mean, while I still think it's also going to be $499, I wouldn't be surprised. I wouldn't be surprised if they still undercut it, just because this is their MO. Yeah. When the first PlayStation was announced, you had the... I don't know if you guys remember this, because this was a long time ago, obviously, but basically, the guy came onto the stage and just stood there for a second and said, $299.99. And then walked off the stage. That was it. That was their presentation. And Sega and everybody else was there were like, fuck.
We're fine.
Because we were over that.
They fucking killed Sega with that.
That alone took Sega out of the... Not that alone. Sega also fucked up going forward.
They had a string of fuck-ups.
Correct. But that definitely set the tone. And then, of course, here we are for the PlayStation 4 reveal and price point reveal. And first, before they even reveal the price point, they basically undid everything Microsoft had just did a couple hours earlier. And, oh, by the way, it's also $100 cheaper.
So,
you know, it's like, holy shit.
So this is how you borrow games.
Yeah. That was the best PlayStation ad I've ever witnessed was that. So question. So do you think they plan for both prices? Let's say $499 to be realistic, because I honestly don't think they're gonna go as low as $400. Let's say that. But
go ahead.
Do you think they have a script for? Let's wait to see what Microsoft said, and then they drop. You know, depending on what they say, they go one or the other.
I don't think they have a script now. I think they will have a script at that point. They're going to be the publicist working on it. Do you think they'll have two
and then they'll pick from?
I mean, realistically, here's the deal. And the deal is these companies take hits on these consoles when they first release. Most of the time, the only company that does not do that is Nintendo. Nintendo is usually out the gate making money on each console.
Yeah.
But they also go cheap. You know, that's why they're and I don't mean cheap. I just they go in expensive. So that's why they're always making money out the gate. But when it comes to these other ones, they are taking losses in the beginning from that. So this wouldn't be unheard of. They're saying right now the cost of manufacturing is $450. You know what I mean? It could take a $50 hit per console.
Ooh, I don't know. $50 a hit.
It may sound like a lot, but if you remember that they make the money on the software, not the hardware. You know, they eventually make money on the hardware. That comes back later on when the price of everything starts
going down. True.
But at the beginning, you are taking. I mean, even if it to realistic, even at $500, it's still going to be a hit because it's costing you $450 to make, and you're only making $50 on each one. But I don't think it's out of the wheelhouse for them to make that insane move. And I'm pretty sure that they're measuring now, saying, okay, if we do this, guys, what are we looking at? You know what I mean? What is the ultimate thing that we may get? You know, what's the worst case scenario if we go $399? What's the worst case scenario? You know, how much are we looking at losing here in the beginning? You know what I mean? And
what I mean in the beginning,
sure, measuring that out. I'm sure they're measuring that.
That'll be it though. If they don't raise the price later on, if they go $399,
yeah,
that's the price.
No, that's not what I mean. What I'm trying to say is that they're right now figuring out if this is what we do, how will our finances be the next year? How long will it take for us? Will we be able to sustain this going forward? And if we do, okay, we need to have Horizon Zero Dawn 2. We need to have – these things need to be there because we need those consoles to go out and we need them to buy these games.
I think Sony has it easy in the sense that they've built their fan base.
Yeah.
All they have to do to maintain it is not fuck up. And what I mean by that is don't try to pull a Microsoft where, you know, when they diverted from the fundamental thing that this game console should do is games. Forget about your marketing shit. I know you're, you know, super thirsty for, you know, to make money of it, but do not fuck with games. That should be the first thing. No, you know,
I don't think that's,
because Microsoft did, and that's how they lost.
Correct.
That's how they lost.
But that's because Microsoft is, I think Microsoft is it's a different company. They are a worldwide. They're thinking way big. Well, you know what I mean. While Sony, PlayStation, on the other hand, is like, no, we are still the gaming console. So I don't think that, because I don't think Sony's going to suddenly go, hey guys, you're going to be able to do, because they don't have the means to do it. You're going to be able to do everything on this console. No, they don't have the means to do that. Even the fucking PSN still has problems. Come on now, you know what I mean.
Well, the reason I mentioned it is because, and I was trying to look for the news piece when I found it, but I'm sure you guys saw it, is that, and these are like rumblings, you know, this is not something that has been like confirmed or anything like that, but it makes you think like, oh my goodness, okay, which was, I'm going to go ahead and drop this next piece. I'm sorry, I don't mean to cut, to interrupt you.
Chaos.
To completely pretend that I'm not here.
No. You're gonna take two for this one. But the mysterious new PS5 feature everyone is talking about might have a disturbing downside. And it talks that in mid-February, it's mid-February, and we don't expect Sony to unveil PlayStation 5 this month, as it was initially rumored. The company hasn't sent out any press invites, and the coronavirus scare might further delay the announcements of the event. But there's no lack of PS5 news. And news findings suggest that an impressive PS5 feature we didn't see coming is real. However, the whole thing might have a huge drawback, as well as the kind of creepy component that many people likely won't appreciate, and that is user tracking. Listen, this consoles are tracking us. That's not a new thing. But if you keep reading, you know, more, it said that the news outlet, BGR.com, several months ago, we spotted the first signs that Sony was working on a digital assistant like no other. This assistant isn't supposed to be like Siri or Alexa, I'm not going to mention the name, or Google Assistant alternative. Sony doesn't need that. Instead, it'll be a new kind of artificial intelligence able to assess your gameplay session and help with real-time information when invoked. stuck on a quest or having trouble defeating a boss, the assistant will be able to help you in either case. So far, that sounds pretty awesome. The assistant might also have a smartphone app that could keep track of in-game content and events. That's what Sony Patton said at that time, at least. Sony never acknowledged the feature, but reports that follow said the PS5 controller might feature a Microsoft to handle voice input. That's starting to get a little bit on the gray side, but that's fine. I have microphones everywhere with Alex XA. This brings us to a new Sony Patton that was published online in late January. The documentation described a new type of functionality for the PlayStation Assistant. The system won't just be able to tell you how to defeat the next boss or complete the quest. It will give you statistics on how others dealt with the same challenge and even provide quick access to microtransactions that might help you along. And the story and the details continue on that thing. I posted it on, I posted the article on the group, but that's the part that got me a little bit concerned, is because, you know, it's going to make it sound like, okay, this is meant to like help you out and stuff like that. But what it's really could end up becoming is, hey, you're stuck in this part. Here are things that you can buy to bypass it if you need to, you know, and that is the concern when you're starting to fuck up with games, you know, because that could lead to messing up with the difficulty settings of games just to promote the usage of set function of set store and or whatever. That's what I mean, where Sony, don't fuck it up. You have the lead position right now. Your fan loves you, you know, and you have yet shown, you know, that you're going back to your old ways. You know, they have been some scares here and there, but for the most part, it seems that you're still, quote unquote, for the players, even if the players kind of force you into finally opening up to crossplay and those type of things. But whatever, you're listening. So listen, I don't want this kind of store thing, special, you know, digital assistant watching me play in order to offer me, you know, anything, because we might not fall for those things, but those are the kind of exploitative BS that other people might actually, you know, be preyed upon, you know?
Yeah.
And that's like microtransactions at the console level, you know, at that, you know, and I don't mean buying it from the store. It's like, oh, your console is designed now to sell you this shit.
Yeah. I can definitely see the concern on that, and that is concerning. Obviously, if that becomes a part of the new wave of consoles, but yeah, I mean, we'll see. Hopefully not. Hopefully, it doesn't come to that point. Yeah. I mean, we all know that there's always patents that they're always put out, and they always want to jump in front of it so you can get it. You know, just in case, hey, somebody makes it. Nope, I own that, so you got to pay me. You know what I mean? So you never know the reason behind it.
That doesn't necessarily mean that they're going to be, you know, implementing X
or Y. There's a lot of stuff. But at the same time, keep an eye out on that just in case.
Definitely very wary of that feature.
Let me put it this way. If Sony is going to be selling PS5s at a greater loss, you better believe that they're going to look for anything and everything that could actually make them money. And that's where you kind of have to get a little worried. Make sure that they don't extend their hand.
They got to know that if they go too predatory, they're going to get backlash for it. There's so many examples of it in the industry. Look at Battlefront 2, for example.
Well, yeah. Yeah, the backslash. I mean, they have to know the gamers are a little bit more knowledgeable nowadays. Not all of them.
They're fickle as shit.
Mr. Gax.
Now, two.
You got two.
Flying up the moon here, just a tad little bit out of all this doom and gloom here. Jesus Christ. Damn. Pokemon Home is out now on the Switch, iPhone, and Android. Well, now,
we're not going to talk about doom and gloom.
Wow. So, you guys remember that I've spoken about Pokemon Bank? Mm-hmm. Right? This is a service they provided, this online service they provided where you can transfer Pokemon from one game to another, you know, even if it was from a different generation. So this is that is the same idea, but for the newer games, right? Mm-hmm. For the Sword and Shield and Pokemon Let's Go, Pikachu and Eevee. It links up to all of this. Now the mobile versions, and this is what really cheered me up out of that gloom and doom you guys were like rambling on about. The mobile version actually connects to the 3DS Pokemon Bank. So God, I hope I actually can bring like the Pokemon I have in that bank back to life. Like this would act if like when it comes out, if it came out, when is it coming out? For the next month. Free March 12th. Okay, so March 12th.
Uh-huh.
So, it is a little bit more expensive. Pokemon Bank was $5 a year. This one is $5 for 3 months. It's $16 for a year. And what is it? $3 for a month. $2.99. So, it's a little bit more expensive. There is a basic free version, though, but it only allows 30 Pokemon and doesn't allow transfers from the bank. The premium one, it's 6,000 Pokemon in storage and the ability to transfer from the bank. So, but yeah, the fact that you can connect to the old Pokemon bank is what really, really piqued my interest right there. Because that was, I mean, it's one of the reasons I really didn't get the game is because I have all of that effort just wasted there. Are you serious? Mm-hmm. Like you sold me this idea that I could transfer it from one generation to the next, and then just out of nowhere, you just seemingly took it away. With no hopes of like actually getting it later on in the future, but hey, they did it anyways. So I'm happy about that.
Nice. And
to anyone out there that actually plays Pokemon, which obviously excludes Sparrow out of that whole list immediately.
Hey, get me out also.
Oh, I know.
It's all about Tentem, the PC Pokemon knockoff. That is getting a lot of people talking about it.
No, I've actually heard about that game.
Yeah, it has a surprisingly.
But it's very Pokemon feel.
Yeah, this might be Chinese knockoff.
Yeah, pretty much. But apparently, so it's a very well made.
Yeah. It has good reviews for the early access and all that. But I'm still not interested.
You have another piece, mister.
Oh, right. I got to do a twofer here, which is completely
unrelated. I saw your position, so you, yeah.
Go ahead. Great, because this is completely unrelated to Pokemon, but Anthem to get substantial reinvention as BioWare rethinks games design because this game doesn't want to die.
Man, that's kind of a rough headline.
This horse has been beaten, stabbed, burned, decapitated. Holy and it's God. Just like fucking Warframe. Just won't fucking die.
Wow.
So again, I'm reading this off the Verge. That part of that title, I might have added myself.
I was going to say, the Verge has gotten ruthless.
I might have had. I might have ad-libbed some of that title. The team behind BioWare's Anthem will be pausing development on short-term updates and expansions to focus on a much broader, quote-unquote, long-term redesign. The EA-owned studio's general manager, Casey Hudson, said today in a blog post, "The game is not yet even a year old. Can you believe it?" Wow. But BioWare appears to recognize that its online shooter, modeled after games like Bungie's Destiny and Ubisoft The Division, really, no way, has been a failure both in its design and its financial success. Oh, this is just so many revelations in one paragraph. We recognize that there's still, this is a quote, apparently, from the general manager. Yeah.
Oh.
It's Casey Hudson. So we recognize that there's still more fundamental work to be done to bring out the full potential of the experience. You haven't brought out any yet. Congratulations. And it will require a more substantial reinvention than an update or expansion. Yes, we all know that. Thank you for actually catching up to the rest of the world. Over the coming month, we will be focusing on a longer-term redesign of the experience, specifically working to reinvent the core gameplay loop with clear goals, motivating challenges, and progression with meaningful rewards. So, you know, guns that actually look different, while preserving the fun of flying and fighting in the vast science fantasy setting. Please do.
Please.
Yeah, very much, please. It's not unheard of for much-hyped games to undergo massive transformations after initial launch flop. Final Fantasy XIV and No Man's Sky are two of the most notable examples. Both games were extensively reworked over the course of multiple years. I mean, different stories, but yeah. And the current states of both games are now considered profound improvements over the launch products. Bungie's Destiny series, which is perhaps the closest analog to Anthem currently on the market, has been reworked every couple of years or so since 2014 with massive fall expansion that revitalized the games and its sequel. I mean, I guess there's still people playing that shit, so. Hi, Ramiro.
Yeah. There you go. Yeah, hi, Ramiro.
So,
keeping the Destiny server alive.
Apparently, unlike this other... Well, I guess everybody has announced it at some point. But yeah, they're coming out to literally say that they're going to rework the game, not exactly from the ground up, which I really think they should, except the flying mechanics.
This just seems to me like a big, hey guys, we've heard, we're working on it. It doesn't feel genuine at all.
In the words of Dream, it feels so corporate talk.
Yes. And I just don't trust any of them.
There's no passion in those words.
There isn't. There's nothing there. And I'm sorry, but Anthem as a game, who wants to revive that? Who is asking to revive that? Except for the small little community. Chaox. I'm sorry. But there is nothing, I think, that will bring that game back from what, so looking at No Man's Sky, okay, that game was built from the ground up, and it was from a small team who the problem there was it needed more time to bake. They just needed more time, and they needed, and it's, I don't know who forced the hand or at some point, but they came out too soon. They didn't rebuild it. They just kept adding what they needed to do, kept improving on it to the point where now it's the game. So it's the goal that they had already had set from the beginning. We're giving it to you now, right?
Final Fantasy XIV was the ground up.
At that point, it's like, you know, we fucked up and we're going to bring this from the ground up. The difference there is Final Fantasy is a name. It's a real name that people know, that people go, you know what? I believe they're doing this and they're spending that additional millions to do this, you know, and you already have a fan base. Where did the fan base of Anthem come from?
That I do agree with.
There's no fan base for them out there. I'm sure you have, you have your users, your players.
There was a big one prior to release.
Yeah,
that was a huge fan base.
But that fan base said, you know what? They fucked up. Oh, this is typical EA. Oh, this is now becoming typical BioWare.
Yeah, man, they booked it. They fucking booked it.
The deal is that they gave a project to an RPG team and said, we need you to make us a looter shooter. And here's this engine that you guys don't really know how to work, but make it happen. And it didn't happen. And now they're not building it from the bottom up. They're just, hey, we're going to keep improving on it. It seems like a waste of time. Seems like a waste of money to me. And it seems like it's not going to get out of the hole that it's in. You know, so it's, why are we doing this? Why are we trying to revive this? Just cut your losses and move on.
I don't trust BioWare being able to revive that game. And what I mean by that is like, I look at games like, you know, The Division 2, when it came out, yeah, it have, you know, generally positive reviews, but people complain about the end game. The end game wasn't great. They abandoned it in droves. You know, a lot of people stopped, you know, me included. And now they're doing their work to get, you know, to get, you know, the people back on track with it. That's not much of a hard work, because people know that at the core of it, the game was good. you know, and it could get good, you know, if they fix the end game and stuff like that. The opposite thing with the Anthem is that Anthem, the only thing that it had that was good, you know, it was the graphic, the and the flying, because the act of shooting, yeah, it looked cool shooting, but the weapons were shit.
Yeah, the skills were cool though.
The loot was super boring and like out there bad. Like it wasn't even planned right.
And the customization was minimal.
Yeah. Yeah. Like how do you survive that? Like how do you bring it back from that? Yes, No Man's Sky, for internet purposes, there was a point where you couldn't tell me to believe in Sean Murray. You know, that guy was as bad to me as Bethesda is. But, I mean, he redeemed himself.
But, he came through, though. He came through, though.
Yeah.
I mean, definitely backed up by his great team, but...
Yeah, mm-hmm. But I'm not sure that I see the leadership of BioWare under the EA umbrella making it happen.
And not this corporate BioWare that we've been experiencing lately.
No. Correct. I agree. Okay. I'm just gonna roll with these two quick pieces here.
Am I getting jumped then?
Yeah,
that's your punishment.
You jumped, and you went first. So,
but I gave it two.
That's it for me though.
These are quick, and I'm gonna just roll through them real quick. Altered Carbon season 2 trailer.
Yes! Yes!
And it stars Anthony Mackie in the role of Kovacs.
I haven't seen the trailer yet, though, but I am excited about this Kovacs season.
It's a teaser. It's nothing, which is why I didn't even bring it up. But I am excited because I did like the first season. I thought it was a decent series for Netflix. Check that out. It's out there, the teaser trailer. And then the second piece, keep it on Netflix, a synopsis for Netflix's Resident Evil adaptation was apparently prematurely uploaded to a press-only website yesterday. This was not yesterday, for the record. The story takes place in the fictional town of Clearfield, Maryland, the background of Washington, D.C., the Umbrella Corporation, and the decommissioned Greenwood Asylum. All three were involved in the creation of the T-virus. The show is set to take place 26 years after the virus discovery. Of course, it would be coming to Netflix. So, not much information there other than the script and the, you know, little details like that. So, looking forward to see what they come up with when it comes to the Netflix series for Resident Evil. Apologies. All right, sir. I'm done. That's all I have. So, what you got? All
right. So, speaking of things nobody gives a shit. wait. I'm sorry, my bad. That was supposed to be the segue I was going to use after the Anthem news, but then you interrupted to speak about your two. So now it doesn't work. My segue doesn't work, but I'm going to use it anyway. So Birds of Prey.
All right, it's a movie.
Oh, right, yeah. Birds of Prey's opening box office was not good, actually. Domestic gross is about half of what Warner Brothers had hopes. Birds of Prey's opening weekends is the worst among any DC Films title, earning $33.25 million in North American theaters, a significantly short of the $56 to $60 million that Warner Brothers had hoped it would deliver. Despite generally positive reviews, and I had to see what they really meant by that, and then I went to the link, and it ended up being another one, you know, of their own reviews. Oh. So you could probably check how it's looking on Metacritic. But anyway, the follow-up to 2016 Suicide Squad seemed to have a number of things holding it back from its box office performance. One of them is the R-rated film, which cuts out any younger crowd that might otherwise be interested in a superhero movie. And two, Variety suggests that the coronavirus outbreak spreading to Southeast Asia has weakened movie going in a market Warner Brothers was counting on. Birds of Prey's total box office is estimated by Box Office Mojo at $84.5 million, $48 million of that coming from overseas. By contrast, Suicide Squad, not without its own problems, still pulled pulled $133.6 million domestically from its August 2016 premiere. But that was a PG-13 film headlined by Jared Leto as the
Joker. Yeah, of course, he was the most important star of the movie.
Mm-hmm, right? Rolling out on a summer month, Birds of Prey focuses on Harley Quinn, popular in her own right, but nonetheless teaming up with Vigilantes Huntress, Black Canary, and Renee Montoya. Okay.
You got it.
Who, despite their long tenures, have largely played supporting roles in Gotham City's narrative. So I heard that, actually, I confirmed, because I was looking for movies to watch, and not that I care to look for this one, but I stumbled upon it. They actually changed the title of the movie.
Oh, for movie theaters only, though.
For movie theaters only, okay.
Yeah, the official name is still that ridiculously long name, which I still kind of find kind of hilarious, I'm not going to lie.
I kind of dig it. But, yeah, now it's just called, "Hey, guys, Harley Quinn." And they call us.
Featuring.
Exactly. Featuring the Birds of Prey.
The Birds of Prey. That was funny.
No, seriously. Harley Quinn, guys. That's what it's called now. And that's all I have.
Awesome, guys. All right, stand by and we'll be right back with our hot topic. Barbecue may not be the road to world peace, but it's a start.
Now that shit is
that's
deep.
That's
right
deep
there.
Right there, right?
Damn.
Wholeheartedly,
I take it back.
All right, guys, we are back. It is time for our hot topic of the week.
Hot topic.
Hot topic again, guys. It is all about the rumor mill. So I have a nice list of rumors here. None of these have been proven, hopefully. Maybe they don't get proven by the time you listen to this episode. But I'm going to throw these rumors out at my two fellow co-hosts. And
we're going to call it, it's time to play Fact or Bullshit.
Oh, my God. There you go.
I like it.
All right, do I get a button or how does this work?
FOB.
Honestly, I'm going to say what the rumor is, and then I'm just going to pick one of you to start. Tell me what you're, you know,
we need to do this live, and we need to have a button.
We should do this live. We should.
Just press the button real quick. Whoever presses it gets to answer first.
All right, so we're going to start.
That was it. I'm sorry.
You're good, sir. We're going to start off small here. Just to kind of wet the palate, as they say. Rockstar will be creating an open world medieval game. David Santos, you go first. What do you think on that? This is an actual rumor for the record. Okay, you can find this on Gaming Bolt if you want to look it up.
So this is fact or bullshit. So we're answering, and then you say if it's
no. We're just gonna talk it out.
Oh, we're just talking it out.
No way it's of knowing. It's a rumor. Yeah, these are rumors. Yeah.
Okay. So I'm gonna call this one bullshit.
Okay.
And the reason why I call this bullshit is because Rockstar right now is in a position where they're making a shit ton of money with Grand Theft Auto Online of Grand Theft Auto 5 Online still. So they're super comfortable. They're super comfortable. Money is just rolling in from that. So much so that they were they went ahead and obviously they owe the fans the story another Red Dead Redemption, and they did, and they delivered. That game was great, you know, for the people that like those type of games. But they were trying to see if they could spark, you know, that sort of level of excitement, you know, among people that like cowboy games, maybe, and horses instead of fast cars and, you know, a city.
Hey, man, who doesn't like a fast horse?
Right? Right? I don't, but I am.
He said, fuck that shit. Give me a car.
Give me a car with several horsepower. Yeah. I'll give you a real horse.
Why do
it
I
only have one horsepower?
So, I mean, you could go up to 4 horsepower, I think.
With one horse?
With the carriage.
With a carriage. There you go. Thank
4
you.
Horsepower. I mean, the steering is horrible.
Shows you how much I know, you know. but what I'm trying to say is, they obviously tried to go to see if they could spark, you know, maybe have 2 money printing machines. And so far, they haven't been successful. So why would Rockstar throw in on making a third, you know, installment, this one in medieval times, and... Like, why would they need to? They don't even need to do another Grand Theft Auto, to be honest with you. And we probably won't get one for a really long time. You know, this might end up being the World of Warcraft syndrome, where they just keep adding shit, but there hasn't been a World of Warcraft 2 because there don't need to be one.
What do you think, Chaos?
I think that it could be possible.
So it's kind of likely.
Yes.
Okay.
Just because of that all of the money from Grand Theft Auto 5 that they're making, why not try to venture, especially with I don't want to say failure of Red Dead Online, because I don't know the numbers for that. I don't know I'm sure it doesn't come anywhere near GTA 5, but look at what I consider to be some of the downfalls in Red Dead Online. The weapons are a little too much. You get a headshot with one of those super steady rifles that the game has, and that's it, man. You just one shot at everybody. It's it's kind of, you know, especially with the way that the aiming works, right? That snap aiming.
But you ask why they wouldn't spend money on making the medieval, and I'll tell you.
But what if you could take that and make it all melee? I mean, yeah, you could have bows and crossbows if you want, but it will come nowhere near what a gun would do.
Because Take-Two Interactive is not interested in that.
I mean, they already have the horse balls physics down. I mean, you gotta use that somewhere else, right? I mean, they spent money and work on this shit.
They did do some serious research.
You gotta use that knowledge somewhere else.
Dear Lord, I can't believe horse balls came up.
I think...
So, just imagine you being able to create your own castle and your own town or whatever. I mean, that's might be going a little too far, because that's not, you don't do that in the Grand Theft Auto games or even Red Dead. But just imagine, or just, you know, all these little castle towns and whatever. I think it'd be a pretty cool idea.
I think it'd be cool too, but it's not coming from Rockstar.
Take-Two
Interactive won't let them, because why spend the money? They already have 2 cash cows here, or 1.5. Like, they really
just
don't need to.
Just a rumor for the record, if anybody wants to know where the rumor came from. First off, it was rumored several years ago, and it came back on Reddit from a couple different users. One of them specifically said that there was a job listing for the company looking for someone to create modular environment pieces with organic finish, carefully following medieval architectural style. So very little to go on, but that's kind of where that stemmed from.
All right,
it'd be hilarious if it ends up being like an update for GTA 5.
Could it be? That's probably where it came from.
Medieval times.
Yeah, exactly.
You can have your own castle.
So I know, right?
So let's make it interesting then. Let's make it into a game where you decide, depending on where you tilt, you decide who gets the point. So what do you think?
Oh, I think it's BS, for the record.
Hey! I mean,
that doesn't mean it's not, but I just said...
No, obviously.
So if we disagree on our opinions that Mad Dog is a tiebreaker?
I guess so, yeah.
I mean, if we both agree on it, then...
Or whoever gets majority, I get...
Okay, that's fine.
Something like that, you know. We'll honor system it out.
Okay, so David has, I guess, a fictional point of some sort.
I guess this is a competition all of a sudden?
Apparently.
Congratulations. Sir, and you, in the game where points don't matter, you are winning.
I gave one horse ball.
One horse ball. All right.
Is it a cold horse ball or a warm?
No, just one horse ball.
Okay. Not cold or warm.
Was basically removed. All right. So my next. You guys are
we're gonna be here till 3 in the morning.
All right. Yes. PlayStation 5 first-party launch titles will not be cross-gen. Mr. Chaos, what say you?
Definitely true. Well, no, that's a little bold. But considering what you guys said earlier about the price, why would you want to make it cross-generational?
Correct, because you can just get it on PlayStation 4.
You're trying to move units.
Okay, interesting. So, kind of likely.
Yeah, I know that definitely true. It's definitely way too bold. But considering that the whole goal originally, you know, especially at release, will be to move units, you want even if it's a time exclusive, you know, I feel like most likely it will be.
Mr. Santos?
Well, it was funny because it was Chaos' boldness that swayed me to change my stance, because I'm just going to go ahead and just sound it out. It is, you know, of course, it's BS. How would they not, you know, offer the option to cross generation play? Like, Microsoft is doing it. Why would Sony not? And then I remember, oh, wait a minute. This is Sony. Of course they wouldn't do that. Why would they? You know, they say they're for the players when it suits them.
Of course.
This is not something that suits them at all. So
of course. Microsoft hasn't done anything to piss them off, so they're cool, you know?
Yeah. So thank you, Chaos. You opened my eyes with your boldness. I almost made a mistake of agreeing with the of disagreeing with the rumor, but I have to say that Sony is not making a cross-generational game.
Okay, I am unfortunately going to be leaning on to David again.
But we agree.
Right, he's agreeing with me.
With Chaos.
Oh, we do? We're on the same page. All right. And here's the reason why. According to Jason Schreier, Kotaku's Jason Schreier, he said on a recent podcast called Split Screen, said that based on what he knows, the game Sony will be launching on PlayStation 5 will not be cross-gen and will instead be exclusive to their new console. Obviously, Jason Schreier does not work for Sony, so he's just going based on some information he has. However, Jason Schreier is the one that constantly breaks news items, stuff. So he is someone to listen to sometimes.
He's the best thing that Kotaku has.
Yeah, it's the reason why Kotaku's still there.
Literally, yeah.
Basically. All right, guys, next one. This one's going to be Metroid Prime Trilogy HD and Super Metroid Remake coming to Switch. Mr. Chaos. Yeah, we're going to go back to Chaos.
Oh, yeah, my popular choice these days. I know very little of Metroid, but those were some really, really long titles.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, sure.
Okay.
Yeah. All right. I mean, Metroid is a popular franchise for Nintendo. Why won't they do that?
What say you, David?
I tell you why they will not do that.
Educate me.
It's because Metroid is not as famous of a Nintendo brand as you might think it is.
Really?
Nobody cares about this particular brand in Japan. And I mean, obviously, I'm being facetious. It has a grab, but it's not the one that we think it does.
I know it's not Zelda levels or Mario levels of it. Like, I know they're not even Pokemon levels, of course. You know, I know it's not nowhere near those levels, but I figured that it had a decent fan base.
Yeah, no, it does. It's just it's not compared to the fan bases of you know Pokemon, Zelda, Mario, of course. This is not like the type of game. I mean, this is not the series that has that grab among Nintendo fans for the most part. Here, sure, I feel like in the West we tend to almost equate the popularity of Metroid with the other Nintendo titles, but that's not so much the case in Asia. And that's why I think also they just released a trilogy not too long ago for the Nintendo's the previous one to the Wii.
You heard my brain, bro. What?
Yeah, I was like, I don't know what you're talking about.
The Wii Plus?
The Wii U. Oh.
Well, Wii U, thank you.
Wii U, that's what you need, an ambulance right now.
am going to lean on the that they are doing this, that this is an actual thing. It has been rumored for some time that the Metroid Prime trilogy was going to be coming, and recently Leaky Pandy. According to Leaky Penny, there's not just
name.
Yes, there's Leaky not Pan. Just one game, but two, and that's where the Super Metroid remake.
I get a point.
And yeah, frankly,
in every contest,
this is mostly just me because I love Metroid. So just I want this to be true for the record.
I will take my point and live with it.
I don't think it will happen, but
all right, moving on to the next one. Nintendo to release a new Switch model mid-2020, Mr. Santos.
Nintendo specifically said they are not going to release a new one on 2020. So, of course it's happening.
There you go. So, apparently it is. Mr. Chaos, what say you, bro?
Well, okay, what is the complete rumor? Like, is it a stronger version of it or something?
Let me see. Update. There are multiple rumors and reports several back. Nintendo had two Switch revisions in the works. One that would be more powerful version of the console, and one that would be a cheaper paired back variant. We've seen the paired back variant already because it's the one that does not have the removable Joy-Cons. Yeah. But nothing else regarding that. There was a recent update. The DigiTimes report also claims that the new Nintendo Switch model will have a magnesium alloy body instead of a plastic one, and that it would boast a better CPU. That seems a little far-fetched.
I was going to say,
maybe a cheaper CPU that will do the same, but yeah, of course it's happening.
I mean, has Nintendo ever... Well, I mean, this is uncharted territory for Nintendo here.
No, it's not. Huh?
When they ever release an upgrade in the middle of
every console they have released has had a mid update.
Really?
It's had improvements. Yes.
Yeah.
It's still the same thing, but it has had improvements.
Like, there's no way Wii Pro or Wii U.
It's never been that level of thing. It's not like a PlayStation 4 to PlayStation 4 Pro kind of change. It's just a PlayStation 4 with, hey, here's some features and stuff.
We're not even going to mention that we got upgraded.
It's never that big of a deal.
Stability improvement.
Yeah.
Right. Exactly. You're right.
Exactly.
I would say that no, it's not going to happen.
Me too. I don't think it's gonna happen.
I'll be enjoying my new Switch. You get
with Alloy whatever and a better CPU, buddy. Sure.
Yeah. You'll see what happens. You'll
it's
see.
Gonna have a 2080 Ti in it. I'm being.
Damn.
Okay. Keeping it on the Nintendo kick, since we're now two in for these. A new Paper Mario to come out this year, 2020. Part of the Nintendo's 2020 lineup. Some speculations for the upcoming Nintendo Direct. We already know of certain things. Animal Crossing, New Horizons, Xenoblade Chronicles, Definitive Edition, Normal Heroes 3, blah, 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 blah. However, a known leaker, Sabi, recently took to Twitter and advised that, yes, a Paper Mario title is also in the works. Mr. Santos!
All right, so you have me... Almost until you said something about releasing this year?
Releasing this year.
No. No way in hell. Sorry. That's what you fucked up.
All right.
You done fucked up.
So that's a negative from Mr. Chaos.
It's gonna happen.
When was the last Paper Mario game?
Oh, it was on the Wii U, bro.
1974.
I don't even think it was on the Wii U. Was it the Wii U? Yeah. It may have been the Wii. So it was
I'm going to say likely.
Likely this year. Okay.
Yeah.
This year.
Yes.
Wait, they haven't announced any. Okay. You're bold. You're bold tonight.
Okay, man.
Honestly, the only reason I'm going to agree with this is because Nintendo hasn't released something really Nintendo-like, and they don't really have much of a lineup or nothing planned that we know.
Luigi's Mansion was released the other day. Thank you very much. It's called Luigi's Mansion. Only the second most famous character to Mario.
It's always about Mario, my friend. Yeah. So, let's just be real.
See, that's why you get the Luigi stare.
It's always about Mario.
Mario's a bully and a dick.
He is.
Well, that he is. But that's why he's number one.
His game is coming out this year. I agree that is very possible.
This year, bro.
This is a long year. My next one is new Silent Hill projects in the making, and they are not gambling games. Mr. Chaos, what say you?
Utter and complete bullshit.
Bullshit indeed. Mr. Santos.
Unadulterated bullshit.
I cannot agree more. Get that shit out of here.
It's Konami, bro.
It's Konami. That's all. That's all we need to know.
I know it. Oh, that's funny. Okay. All right. Cyberpunk 2077 was delayed due to, quote, extremely unsatisfactory, end quote, performance on base Xbox One and base PlayStation 4. Mr. Santos.
I'm going to have to agree with that.
Oh, God, me too. So hard.
It's
so hard.
I remember The Witcher 3 when it came out on PlayStation and Xbox also on the base consoles, as we're calling them now. It wasn't that hot, so I'm sure that CD Projekt Red was looking at this, you know, their latest baby, thinking like, no, we don't want that to happen again, son. We this game is something else. People are expecting a level of polish unprecedented. We can't fuck this up.
Yeah, and because of that polish, because of how well it looked, just imagine that. Yeah, they ran this on obviously PC, so they gotta like scale it down to console. So let's assume that they try to keep as much of it as possible, as faithful as to what they showed us, and they can't.
Yeah,
because the base console, it's about to have a heart attack.
Yeah, I agree.
My shit's ready to take off half the time.
Yeah, I know. Every time I run Apex, it's about a rocket's about to launch out of my this room.
I agree with you both. Honestly, I'm almost a little worried that I'm like, I might have to wait for PlayStation 5 to get this game.
I was just thinking, like, oh, God, I'm going to have to wait for PlayStation 5.
We might want to.
and the thought of it hurts.
Yeah, I agree.
Wait, who's going day one on PlayStation?
Five? Me?
Yeah! It'll be the first time in the history.
No, I did day one on Nintendo 64, and that's why I never went back. I never did that shit again.
Why? What's wrong with the Nintendo 64?
There were no games, bro.
No games, bro.
I had Pilot Wings, and that was it. That was all it was.
I didn't get a day one. I don't think I got a day one.
I mean, fuck Mario 64.
Right? It was
Pilot Wings.
I'm telling you, it was messed up. All right.
Who wants that kitty shit?
To be fair, Pilot Wings was actually a fun game, guys.
It was fun.
The next one, The Order 1886, actually has a sequel in development, and it will be coming to next-gen consoles, Mr. Chaos Reaper.
I want it to be true. I didn't play the first one, but it had a really cool concept to it.
I did play the first one, to the end.
Yeah, I know something, but it took you like, what, 30 minutes?
Actually, a little longer. About 5-6
just,
hours.
Just a little.
It has a cool concept, a cool setting from what I've seen. I would like more of it as long as it'll make me play the first one.
Okay.
I mean, is it free at this point? Do we still have to pay for it? Dude, if it's free, I'll go.
I've seen it, no. I'm sure they would. Why? Has it been on PlayStation Plus? I don't think so.
Seriously, why haven't?
It's been as low as $5 at one point. So
you think they're saving it for when they really have nothing? Like, there's absolutely nothing else? Like, listen, guys, we ran out of shit to give you. Here's the order or whatever.
Yeah, it could be. Santos, what say you?
Yeah, bro, come on. That's bullshit. There's not much to say on this. Come on. Let's be real.
Is there a fan base for this?
Yeah, exactly. Let's start with that.
Honestly, there's always been questions regarding it. But personally, I thought the game was fine. I didn't see anything wrong with it. It was more spectacle than it was gameplay. Because man, graphically it was a fucking gorgeous game.
Right, it looked amazing.
But in the end it was just really a cover based shooter that didn't really do much else but cover based shooter. You know what I mean? So it was just like, okay. And that's really it. So but the only reason I will say that I think this will happen is because known insider Black Osiris, who has leaked stuff that actually has come true, is the one who has mentioned this. So I'm going to go with Black Osiris and say that, yep, I think this is happening.
Wow.
I know.
Be wrong then. That's what you want.
It's okay to be wrong.
Okay. Yeah. Microsoft were reportedly looking into purchasing Platinum Games last year, but the deal fell apart. Mr. Santos, your favorite Platinum game was almost a first-party studio. According to this rumor, what say you?
Oh, man. Well, that would have excited me in the sense that I was always concerned about Platinum's stake. I didn't want them to, like, die. So, but now Tencent, ended up having a huge influx of money. They bought into it. So they don't own them outright, and they're still independent, and they're safe. So I like the idea of them being independent, polishing and possibly polishing other games. From what I heard, that's what they're looking to do.
Yeah.
So in regards to this thing with Microsoft, shit, that's a good one. I'm just gonna say it's bullshit. I mean, I don't think Microsoft, if they have the money to get a company, right? Fuck, I don't know. Shit, this one's hard.
Just yes or no. What do you think? Is it bullshit or not? Your initial reaction that is bullshit.
Yeah, I think it's bullshit. Well, because Microsoft could make it happen. They certainly have the resources. If a deal fell through, it was not because Platinum Games was being unreasonable, you know. But Platinum Games, it's a name. It's a no fucking name. Microsoft should have and should have grabbed them while they could. So if they didn't, it's probably because it never happened.
Okay. Yes.
Considering that Microsoft has been shopping around for developers, I'd say that it's probably true. I mean, I can't really speak much for Platinum, but it could definitely be a possibility that it happened. Maybe just because they wanted to keep their independence, it fell through.
Possibly.
That's true. You know? Yeah, that's true.
For me, I feel like it's not on the table only because of the scale-bound issue. I feel that never been on the table because of that. So I feel that I personally feel this is bullshit. And that's just more hopeful thing. But that's just me only because of the scale-bound thing. But I agree with you both that you know, who knows?
Hey, it's probably likely, yeah. Maybe because of scale-bound they dropped it.
Maybe, yep.
Like, you cancel the game, like, you're going to treat us like this? Like, nah, bro, we're good. Thank you.
That's true. All right, BioShock 4 has been reportedly in development since 2017. Wait, this has already been proven, hasn't it? What the hell?
Possibly?
Actually, no. This is actually pretty recent. So, Santos, what say you?
if this is a fact or bullshit,
this is a rumor. Yeah,
I think that I can see it happening. I can definitely see it.
Fourth game in the series by 2K, Mr.
2K. Oh yeah, definitely. Hey,
what you think?
Have they worked on anything lately? I'd say it's a possibility.
I think so too. I think there was some rumblings on what is it? Sites. What do you call those sites where you listing job listings? So
I think that's what it is, yeah.
All right. Sorry, give me 1 second
here. Okay.
My bad.
Nope.
New Batman game will be a soft reboot and kick off a DC Games universe.
Oh boy.
And to be followed by Superman. This is quite the rumor.
Oh, wow.
That's quite the rumor.
It's actually pretty specific. Mr. Chaos.
Yeah, I will say.
I'm going to say partial bullshit.
Partial bullshit.
I'm going to give you half a shit.
yeah. I believe that, yes, a Batman game may be in the works, but I don't think that. I hope that I'm trying to do a video game. Please don't. Although I'm not gonna lie, seeing anyone give a shot at making a Superman game, I would love to see that, because that just the thought of it is hell for me.
Yeah. it is story nightmare, that's for sure.
Yeah.
Mr. Santos, what do you think?
Yeah, I'm gonna call this one bullshit. Also, I do believe that a Batman game, it's in the works. That part is true. The part that makes it hard to believe is the DC universe. You know, especially when you mentioned Superman game. Listen, son, Superman games cannot be done. All right, period. You can't.
Let's make a game about Dr. Manhattan while we're at it.
Yeah.
Hey, I'd be down to not play that. So,
I mean, it'd be a troll game where you just do whatever you want. Exactly. There's no real substance to it.
I agree.
Yeah.
All right. Next rumor.
Walking around snapping fingers and vaporizing people.
Yeah, really good. As we all know, The Wolf Among Us 2 is actually happening, apparently, as we saw on the Game Awards. Mm. But also, apparently, is Tales of the Borderlands 2.
Ooh.
Mr. Santos, what do you think?
I can see this one happening. If only because of a lot of people remember that game being one of the better ones of that type of game.
Mm-hmm.
So yeah, I don't see if they're working on the what did they say was Fairy Tales 2?
The Wolf Among Us.
Thank you. I remember.
Did you just say Fairy Tales 2?
Yeah. The Wolf Among Us.
The Fairy Tales.
Yes, I could Wolf definitely.
I can see how you got confused.
Yeah.
So, in his defense, the actual graphic novel that The Wolf Among Us is based on is called Fables.
There you go, Fables.
So, yeah, okay. See, it's Fairy Tales. That's hilarious. Mr. Chaos, what do you think, sir?
Because of the way that you guys have spoken about the game, which I understand it's a very, very, very small pool sample, but I would say likely, yeah. Again, the way that you guys talk about it, it's one of the best Telltale games that's out there. So, sure, why not?
Yeah, all right. I kind of have to agree.
Yeah.
All right, Skull and Bones. That Ubisoft title that's been delayed and then delayed again has been rebooted completely before release.
And it's now Assassin's Creed.
It's because the creative director left. They're just starting from scratch.
Oh God!
And so that's the reason why it's gotten delayed and delayed and delayed. Mr. Chaos, what say you?
Wait, well, which part of this is the rumor?
The fact that it's been completely rebooted. Starting what we saw in the thing is not what we're going to get in the end.
Ah.
Wait, you haven't been telling us your stake on each of them.
I have.
Yes.
Oh, you have?
Yeah, yeah.
Oh, okay.
Wow, are you like, you okay there, buddy?
Somebody else is tired too. Yeah.
I'm paying attention. Sort of. Anyways, I don't know, man. Because has it been delayed over and over again?
Yes.
Yeah.
So it's stuck in development hell?
Apparently.
So this may very well not happen.
This may become vaporware.
I'm gonna say bullshit.
Okay, Mr. Santos, your thoughts?
I'm also gonna call it bullshit. I mean, what we saw was pretty advanced, and what would be the problem with retooling? Why would it need to be retooled? I could see. Things changing, maybe even a storyboard being changed, but rebooting the entire game, like, for what purpose? At that point, they just cancel it.
You're gonna have if they actually go through with this, I picture a Destiny repeat.
Yeah, kind of like it, what it was.
Where everything got scrapped and they have to put something together in the end.
Yeah. So, no, yeah, I mean, at this level, I feel like Ubisoft will release it in whatever state it is, because they always do.
And they just trades it along the way.
Yeah. So they're not thinking of rebooting it. At that point, they'll just straight out cancel it. So, no, this is bullshit.
All right. Personally, I think that this is also bullshit.
We make convincing arguments.
Yes, actually you do. And the source that I saw on there is like... That's kind of
shady.
Kind of shady, guys. I don't know. Kind of shady. Assassin's Creed Far Cry sequels releasing March 31st of 2021.
Wait. Assassin's Creed and Far Cry?
Yes. By March 31st. I'm sorry. By March 31st, 2021.
So no Assassin's Creed this year? Yes. Or
no Assassin's
Creed? It's both. Oh, wait. What? Oh, okay. So both games for next year?
Yes. For early next year. For first quarter.
I'm going to say fact.
He says fact. Okay.
I'm going to say fact, too. I think so. I mean, that was their game plan, right? They wanted to...
skip a year, right?
Yeah. Something like that, yeah.
All right. Okay. So that's an easy one there. Ratchet and Clank game will be a PlayStation 5 launch title. Now that Insomniac Games is part of the first-party PlayStation Studios. Mr. Chaos.
Fact.
Ooh. Fact it
what?
Is.
What is fact again? I'm sorry.
New Ratchet & Clank game will be PlayStation 5 launch title.
No, bro. Come on. Okay, so they purchased Insomniac, right? Insomniac was the makers of
Insomniac, yeah.
Right. They purchased them, all right.
Yeah, they belong to them now.
Right. You think they're going to fucking put them to work in Ratchet and fucking Clank? That sounds like a waste of talent.
It could be a small release title.
No, don't get me wrong. Yes. But this is not what the company is going to want to like head into, you know, on it. If anything, they should be working on a new amazing IP for the PS5 that can showcase the power of the PS5. They're not going to put them to work in fucking Ratchet and Clank.
So... I first off think that Insomniac Games is not a small studio.
No,
so it is possible. One, two. I know that the main thing that they're focusing on is the next Spider-Man game. But they obviously still have everything, you know, all the assets and everything from the last Ratchet and Clank game, and it doesn't need to be something big. Will it be a launch title? I don't know. Maybe. It depends. If it's already been in the works, chances are it's been in the works for a while. If you know, because thinking of the last Ratchet and Clank is, so it's not far fetched, but yeah, you're not gonna see something new from them just yet. They're either gonna do Spider-Man, the Ratchet and Clank, another Resistance.
Oh my god! Another Resistance,
hey,
bro.
I'm just trying to say you're not gonna see a new IP. I'm just saying
I will see another Ratchet, two more Ratchet and Clanks before I see another Resistance.
What is wrong?
I don't know what happened there.
What's wrong with Resistance?
It was not a bad series. Don't get me wrong, but it is not that type of game. Is not a game of this time. That type of game is a game of the time that it got released. You don't see a lot of dedicated first-person shooters only unless you're fucking Doom. And yeah, that's why, unless you're fucking Doom, because you got to be better than Doom.
I mean, like a game where you shoot aliens and shit.
Yeah, but that's not, again, look at Halo. Who gives a shit about Halo right now?
Well, that's because they shit the bed on the story. That's completely different.
Hey, listen, I got news for you. The Resistance story was pretty good.
Whoa.
Was pretty good.
You're like 2 seconds from getting
kicked. It ended. There is think about this. What would a first person Resistance game will be in 2020? Is it gonna be a looter shooter?
I don't know. That's gonna have to be for someone to do it.
Listen, we're talking about, you know, what we think if this is gonna happen or not. Would I want a Resistance? Sure, yeah, that'd be awesome. But do I think it's smart for them to work on one, you know, based on the current, you know, market conditions? Well, very likely it won't. And very likely it also won't be fucking Ratchet and Clank. If anything, it'll be a new IP, and it's not coming it's not coming this
and
year.
You're just pissing them off, parade.
On a launch window.
Hey. These are all rumors, anyway.
I will put money on this one.
Grain of salt. I mean, obviously, I just mentioned Resistance because they made Resistance. That was really what and I will have you know, the Resistance series was a great series. Okay.
Yes.
Yeah, it was.
It was a great
series.
One was a decent game. Listen, no. one was a decent game. Two was garbage.
Two was not garbage.
Three was great. No, I owned all three.
So did I.
I don't know what game you play, but two was garbage.
Two was not garbage. Two took a step back.
House party. It was not broken. I'm not going to take you.
It was not broken. Listen, serious. House party has titties and ass. Who doesn't like titties and ass?
Like shooting aliens.
I'll take titties and ass over shooting aliens. Any day.
Oh my god.
You're listening to this, Ms. Dream.
She knows it. And she hopes for it too.
I know.
Oh my god. All right, guys. That brings us to the end. to the end of an awesome episode. The real episode 199. Thank you so much for tuning in. Once again, guys, please go to goodgame.rocks. Join the conversation there. And, of course, please like, subscribe, share the podcast with everyone. This is Mad Dog signing off for this week. Thanks so much for joining us, Mr. Chaos Reaper.
Well, I would very much like to play Resistance games now, but I also like ass and titties. So I think I'm going to download House Party and give that a shot. No, I'm just kidding. I'm definitely not downloading House Party. That is very much not happening.
Fair enough. But
this was a great episode. Those rumors were pretty interesting.
Awesome. Mr. David Santos, take us home, sir.
I see a House Party on PlayStation 5 before there is a Ratchet and Clank. I guarantee you.
There's something wrong with you, son.
We're gonna record this. We are recording this. We're gonna actually put it down somewhere. And because I actually remember a specific bet that you made at some point where that I wrote down, and you were like, "Man, was I really wrong?"
What was it? I forgot.
It was something that
I think I remember. It was something
Xbox. Xbox to make online gaming free. stop charging for it.
Well, I mean, they brought Game Pass. It's close enough.
Is it free? It
costs $1 for 3 months.
But you
how about that?
To play online,
that's
you still need
not free.
Gold.
Huh?
You still need the games with gold to play online.
Oh, I thought we were talking about games.
No. All right, guys.
Yeah, that's bullshit.
We'll see you next week.
That's the biggest rumor.
GG!